Welcome to Mercedes-Benz of North Haven. We have fully remodeled our facility to give you and your vehicle an even better sales and service experience. Come see the full lineup of Mercedes-Benz and choose the car of your dreams. Sit and relax comfortably while you wait for your vehicle in our new service center. Let our knowledgeable and friendly staff take care of you and your Mercedes-Benz. Mercedes-Benz of North Haven, 620 Washington Avenue. See us online at mercedesbenzofnorthhaven.com.
Excuse me, the chain on this pen is too short.
There. Is that better, Martin?
Not really.
Here's the thing, Martin. Banks can't have people taking their pens.
Well, sure.
It's time to bank human again. That's why at TD Bank, we're open longer than any other bank. And yes, our pens are chain-free. TD Bank, America's most convenient bank.
Now you can go to the beach any time of the year. At the Beach House in Milford, Connecticut, the Beach House follows their own philosophy of fresh is best, with an exquisite cuisine of natural hormone-free beef, organic chicken, and the freshest of fish. The charming Oak Bar and the Chef's Exhibition Kitchen invite everyone to enjoy the delightful atmosphere and the flirtatious views of the Sound. Come to the Beach House in Milford, Connecticut. You never know who may be waiting inside.
Love my BMW of North Haven.
Every season starts with a hope and a dream to play for the ultimate title, to become NCAA national champions. And you can experience it live at the 2014 NCAA Women's Frozen Four, March 21st and 23rd in Hamden, Connecticut, hosted by Quinnipiac University. Affordable tickets now available. Visit ncaa.com/tickets today and make a date with champions.
Sometimes it's like we're still in college. But with a mortgage, and the furniture's a lot nicer. And suddenly, the most important person in my life is someone I haven't even met yet.
Who matters most to you says the most about you. At MassMutual, we're owned by our policy owners, and they matter most to us. As you plan your next step, we'll help you get there.
Hi, I need a new debit card.
One moment, please, Stephen.
Great.
You should receive your new card within 10 to 12 business days.
10 to 12 business days?
Business days are considered Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday.
I know what business
Thursday,
days are.
Friday. Business days do not...
It's time to bank human again.
Saturday.
That's why at TD Bank, all of our checking accounts come with a free debit card on the spot, any day of the week. TD Bank, America's most convenient bank.
This is the moment.
This is the moment.
Tonight is the night.
Tonight is the night.
This is the moment.
This is
the moment.
It's the return of the Mac.
Return of the Mac.
We'll fight till it's over. We'll fight till it's over.
This is the moment.
Return of the Mac.
Check out MacAchusetts.com for information on the Mac Basketball Championships in Springfield, Massachusetts from March 6th to the 10th, 2014.
Back on November 14th, they lost by about 55 points to UConn in the opener. They have not topped 59 points all season long in their games. They've struggled to reach 50 in their last three outings, including two losses at the Miami Thanksgiving tournament, losing to Missouri 68-45. Consolation loss to St. Francis of Brooklyn 56-49. And none of their players averaging in double figures. And a lot of they're going more with a youth movement right now because much of the leadership of last year's team is gone.
Yeah, you know, and Jen will do a good job with them, you know, down the stretch. They are picked second, you know, in the America East. So I think that there's some bright spots for them, but I think that they're young, they're making some mistakes, they're not scoring. I don't know how their confidence is at this level at this point in the season, but, you know, they're going to be opening up conference play pretty soon. And, you know, you can be as poor a team as you want to be in that non-conference schedule, when everything, the slates get kind of erased, and now you're ready to play for the games that are going to matter at the end of the year to get you in the tournament.
Yeah, you mentioned some of the future opponents for the Bobcats. The newest rankings are out in the collegeinsider.com mid-major poll. Quinnipiac, despite the 3-4 record, is 24th in the top 25. But when you look at their strength of schedule, at last time that was computed, Quinnipiac's strength of schedule nationally is 4, mainly because Louisville had the number one RPI in the country at the time that the number 4 ranking was established. St. John's was number 2. Quinnipiac lost to both teams, so they're getting credit for playing the tougher conferences and the tougher teams individually.
Well, you know, Trisha's always been somebody who says, you know, I want to play a tough preseason or pre-conference schedule. So I can prepare my team to really get into that part of the schedule where, you know, you got to win every game. So I think she's done a nice job of that. She doesn't back down from anybody, and I think the players like to do that. I think they like, you know, traveling. I don't know if they like that stretch where they seem to be going all over the country. But, you know, I think they like the fact that they're playing good basketball teams, and you're going to.
Quinnipiac not too long ago, and I am in the receiving votes total as well. So a lot of these names are challenging foes, and as you mentioned, Trish wants to set them all up because once Friday kicks around, it counts.
Well, you know, and you talk about that poll, that mid-major poll, and one of the reasons we wanted to get into the MAC, there's three teams from the MAC in that poll. So it's a better conference in terms of, you know, the opponents that you're playing.
Certainly is. Gonzaga, by the way, in case you're wondering, number 1 in the mid-major poll with 27 first-place votes. St. Mary's, 2 years ago, Quinnipiac won the St. Mary's tournament out in Moraga, California, beating both St. Mary's and Minnesota that particular weekend. St. Mary's is 4, one of a handful of undefeated teams in that top 25 poll, the college mid-major. So again, a lot of quality opponents, both past and present, on Quinnipiac's dossier. But tonight, an in-state rival, which is a team that we've seen better days of this club. You and I last year saw the game in which Quinnipiac lost at Hartford 67-61. I was looking at the box score before the game tonight. It turns out the big difference in that game was free throw shooting. Hartford was 17 of 24. Bobcats were just 4 of 6, and Quinnipiac lost by 6 points.
Yeah, when you don't get to go to the line as much as your opponent, you got a probably good chance that you're not going to win those games, assuming that the talent is equal. You know, you go to the line 6 times and they go to the line 14 or whatever. I think that's what you said. You're not going to the line very much.
No, but all the other numbers are practically even. So equal number of rebounds, 34 apiece. One difference of 1 in turnovers, 24-23. Quinnipiac at 16 steals. Hartford shot a little better from the field at 45% to 40%, but again, it turned out to be the free throws were the key. And that was the only loss last year to a team that you might say Quinnipiac should have won. The other two losses were to the Atlantic Coast Conference. You're not going to fault the Bobcats for losing to Georgia Tech and Maryland. This is the one that kind of got away from them, and I think Trish has these girls focus on, let's get that one back.
Well, and this is a good time to get it back because, again, as we've said prior to this, is that, you know, it's not the typical Hartford team. They're somewhat struggling, and you just hope they don't wake up tonight.
And as we're looking ahead also, just to set you up for our future schedule, on Friday, the big doubleheader in the Metro Atlantis Conference opener, Quinnipiac will face Marist, the women's basketball at 6 p.m., the Quinnipiac men Open MAC play against Fairfield at 8:30. Then the women take some time off for exams before returning against the Great Danes of Albany on Sunday, November 15th, December 15th. And then the trip to Buffalo just 4 days before Christmas. First of two trips the Bobcats will make for women's basketball in that part of New York State. They'll face Canisius on a Saturday afternoon tilt. That's a 2 o'clock start on the 21st. Quinnipiac and Hartford in women's basketball. We'll have more information for you as we get on through the evening. This concludes the pregame show. The starting lineups, the opening tip come your way right after this. When you're up.
Performed tonight by the Quinnipiac University Pep Band.
That's basketball brought to you by TD Bank, America's most convenient bank. By Pepsi, the choice of a new generation. By Dunkin' Donuts, America runs on Dunkin'. By Moro Motors, Mercedes-Benz and BMW of North Haven. By Mass Mutual, they like to help you make good financial decisions to protect the people who matter most to you. And by the Beach House Restaurant in Milford. What's not to like? Great food, great staff, super music.
Back at the TD Bank Sports Center, Bob Mortali and Bob Tipson. Lineups being introduced for the Hawks and the Bobcats. We will do the same for you. Start with Brittany McQuain inside, 5'11 senior from Independence, Missouri, the reigning Metro Atlantic Conference Player of the Week. Ellen Cannon's back in the starting lineup after not starting for three games. Ellen, the 5'6 senior guard from Westchester, Pennsylvania. Also Jasmine Martin, 5'8 junior from Sicklerville, New Jersey. Samantha Guastella, 6'1 junior from Red Bank, New Jersey. And Gillian Buapshire at the point, the 5'10 junior from Washington, D.C. For Hartford, they go with Taylor Clark as a forward, a 6-foot senior from Sayre, Pennsylvania. Morgan Lum, a 5'8 freshman from North Andover, Massachusetts. Milana Gilbert, 6-foot senior from Smyrna, Delaware. By the way, Milana has two brothers who play for the Fairfield.
It's not about what you've done, it's about what you do. It's all about where you're going, no matter where you've been. Let's go.
What happened was, and if you remember that game, she got the ball the first three times down the floor and went one-on-one, and she didn't make any shots. So I think Trish probably said, well, maybe this isn't going to work right now. We have to get her in the positions where she's more comfortable. Coming off the bench, she may be more comfortable. I still think they just haven't found that fifth starter. I think there'll be more experimenting in terms of figuring out who that's going to be.
I mean, we look at Nikki's numbers. For example, the first three games, she scored 9 against North Carolina A&T, 14 against Louisville, 10 against Tennessee Martin, all off the bench. Got to start beginning with the America game, but it scored just 6 points combined in the three games. She's more of a slasher player and going to the hoop a little more frequently than Ellen, who basically is an outside shooting specialist. Last year against Hartford, Cannon had 3 three-pointers, finished with 9 points. She had 9 against Missouri State, but she was in a slump for about 3 or 4 games in which she went 1 of 19 from the field before knocking down 3 three-pointers against Missouri State Bears, so she's more of the outside specialist.
Yeah, and she really isn't making baskets right now. You know, she's averaging 2.9 points a game, you know, and she's just not, I don't know if she's not comfortable. She's only shooting 25% from the three-point arc and 20% from the field. So, you know, she's got to get on track a little bit and maybe take a little bit of the pressure off herself. Just hit an open shot, let it come to you, and contribute that way.
Now, you watch her in practice. She does put the effort in, the time in. She'll take some extra shots after the main practice is over, and she'll try to see if she can put it in the hole again tonight. Hartford's bound the court in the road red uniforms with white numbers, and white lettering. Quinnipiac on the home whites with the dark blue numbers. Our officials for tonight's game, Kathleen Lonergan, Kenneth Kelly, and Mark Resch. So it's the Bobcats going from right to left in the first half. Brady McQueen in the middle will jump it up against Milana Gilbert. We're all set, ready to go. Game number 8 of the season for Quinnipiac women. A tap control by Guastella. Right side pass for Abshire, dribbling with the right hand on the wing. Stops her dribble on top from McQueen. Left side, Jasmine Martin. Drives to the left low post. Cross court feed for Cannon in the right corner. Doesn't shoot. Bounce pass inside for Guastella. Knocked away, loose on the floor. A tie ball. The arrow goes in favor of Hartford.
Now Hartford playing, you know, man-to-man, but, you know, they're really, really watching Brittany McQueen. The two low post players are basically, you know, trying to front and go behind her so she can't get an easy pass into the post.
Hartford with the ball in the forecourt. Taylor Clark on the near sideline. Now it on top for Bultron. They get it to the left side for Engler and away from the play. A foul's going to be called, an offensive foul against Hartford.
Well, two bad possessions, one for each team.
Milana Gilbert's foul, her first, and the first on the team, the first 28 seconds. Some pressure in the backcourt. Abshire working against a double team. Bounces one to her right for Guastella, who gives it back to Boo. Now Boo weighs everybody down court, and she'll work one-on-one in the forecourt against Engler. Dribbling at the logo, stops with the dribble, bounces one to the left for Guastella, left of the foul line. Guarded closely by Clark. Puts it on the floor to her right once, left side Martin. On the wing, drives to the foul line. Stops, off balance, throws up a shot from 14 feet, no good off the rim. McQueen skies for the rebound and controls it on the left baseline. Back out for Abshire, left wing on the drive, down the lane, up off the glass, no good. Rebound to Morgan Lum. Lum racing up court for the Hawks. They're going left to right here in the first half. Lum to the top of the circle, left side for Clark against Cannon. On the wing, dribbles to her right. No score in the first minute and 10 seconds here at the TD Bank Sports Center. Bultron on top, right side Engler against Cannon. Goes back for Bultron inside, pass intended to go inside, was knocked out of bounds. Last touch for the Bobcats.
Well, Brittany McQueen really did a nice job of defending the post there. It kind of got halfway around and then got a deflection, knocked it out of bounds.
So it'll be Hartford to throw in at the end line to our right. It'll be Bultron to throw in into the left corner for Lum. Lum working on Cannon, going baseline on the drive, off the glass, and good.
Well, again, a little bit too much baseline that time. You know, you got to square up on her and not let her take that baseline drive.
2-0, Hartford in the lead. Ellen Cannon from downtown, right corner, no good off the rim. Ball was loose off the floor, picked up by Boltrin. Flips it back out for Lum. Hartford on the run. Lum to the forecourt. Left side, Englert drives toward the end line, kicks it back out on top for Boltrin. Left side for Lum, three-pointer around the rim, no good. Rebound for McQueen, pushing behind, and they're going to say tie ball once again as Gilbert got tied up with Martin. The arrow, though, in favor of Quinnipiac. First substitution, Alyssa Rees, a six-foot freshman from Bloomfield, played her high school ball at Northwest Catholic, and she replaces Milana Gilbert. So some pressure still in the backcourt as Abshire works against the double team. Bounces one to the left to Guastella. Sam brings it across into the forecourt just in front of us. Stops her dribble. Bumps with a defender. They get to Abshire. Left wing. Left corner for Martin. On the drive to the baseline. Kicks it back to McQueen to the foul line. Right side. Cannon. Three-pointer is good.
Well, she got in that corner where she felt comfortable. You know, one for two from there. Nice shot.
3-2. Bobcats with the one-point lead. In the forecourt, Englert out on top of Boltrin against Abshire. Doesn't dribble. Bounces one to her left for Englert. She brings Martin out with her. Englert on the move to her right. Spins up a foul line. Bounces one to the low post. Knocked away by McQueen. Picked up by Rees. Rees can't control it. Ends up in the hands of Guastella. Out for Abshire. Bobcats on the move. Abshire right of the foul line. Back to Cannon. Right corner jumper again. Off the rim this time. No good. Martin scraps to the rebound in the left corner, brings it back out for Abshire with five substitutions about to come in for the Bobcats. We're back to the Gold Rush substitution pattern. Abshire dribbling with the left hand, and there's going to be an offensive foul called on Martin as a Hartford defender, Englert, goes down. So the foul will be against Jazz, her first.
Well, you're right. We're going back to the Gold Rush and maybe trying to wear a team down and try to play as many minutes as you can with fresh bodies.
Cameron Warner, Nikolai Ostergaard, Shayna Earle, Maria Napolitano, and Adelie Martucci all in the game for the Bobcats. Quinnipiac leads 3-2, 17-12 left in the first half. Deanna Mazes in for Hartford. She's at the point. She sends the ball to her right for Amber Bepko, who's just inserted in the game. Shayna Earle, though, knocks the ball away out of bounds to the far sideline. It'll be a Hartford ball.
Good defense that by Earle. You know, she got a hand in there. A lot of pressure on the dribbler.
Inbounds to Mazes, the freshman from Densburg, Pennsylvania. Pass to the right. Caught by Boltrin. Now to the right corner for Mesa. On the drive of the baseline. The feed inside for Rees. Lost control, then recovers. Left-handed hook shot is good.
Well, you know, kind of a lucky shot, I think. You know, she turned and she had the ball actually shot before she saw the basket.
4-3 Hartford. Ostergaard between the circles in the forecourt. Goes down left side of the lane. On the drive. Layup is no good, but she's fouled and she'll go to the line. Alyssa Rees with her first.
You know, those are the ones last year she was making, and it looks like she's just not getting it up high enough. It looks like it's going to go in, but she kind of puts it below the rim, and then it hits the rim.
Ostergaard will shoot the first of two. Again, made her first career start against American University. Ended up with 14 points in the Louisville game down in Kentucky. Takes her time, spins the ball in her hand. The free throw is around the rim, no good. Now I can say she's 11 of 21 from the foul line this season. I didn't do it before the shots. I know you'd say something.
You don't want to jinx.
I just report the numbers. That's my job. Second free throw for Nikki is good. So she makes one out of two, and we're tied at 4-4. Some Bobcat pressure in the backcourt. Martucci guarding Mesa as Mesa brings it to the forecourt, dribbling to the right wing, continues to dribble, and then Martucci hooked her on the penetration toward the low post.
Yeah. Coach Rosati over there was screaming and yelling at what she was dribbling the ball up. You know, she was getting shoved and pushed.
Martucci's first personal, team second. Hartford throw in, Mazer, right corner on Martucci. Gets it back to Boltrin, top of the circle. Bounces one to her left for Bepko. Bepko's pass knocked away by Warner. Ball loose on the floor, controlled by Earle. Earle in the forecourt, does not have numbers. She's 1-on-3, but she drives to the right low post, off the glass, off the rim, no good. And it's rebounded by the Hawks. Ball's coming our way, out of bounds. It'll be Quinnipiac possession as Hartford threw the ball over the point guard's head.
Well, you know, again, bad possession by Earl. She was going, as you say, 1-on-3. She just sort of pulled it out and get some other players running down into the court. Maybe they can get a reversal and a jump shot. And then Hartford just throwing the ball away after a rebound.
Ostergaard's just in front of us. He inbounds to Earl with 16-12 to go in the first half. Earl looking for a pick from Warner. Gets one to her right. Now to Ostergaard. Far sideline, dribbling into the lane with a left hand. Little floater off the rim, no good. Goes short again, just like you pointed out a minute ago. Ball goes out of bounds, and it's going to be a Quinnipiac possession.
You know, she's doing everything she used to do last year. She's spinning. She's putting it between her legs. She gets into the paint, but she's not finishing. She's not getting the ball up over the rim.
Early inbounds for Warner on the drive. Layup is good from the left side.
Great cut that time by Cameron.
6-4, Bobcats with the lead. Pass down court off the hands of Bepko out of bounds on the nearest sideline to our right. It'll be Bobcat ball after the timeout. 15 minutes, 57 seconds remaining in the first half. Quinnipiac with the 6-4 lead on the Hartford Hawks. We'll be right back.
Now you can go to the beach any time of the year at the Beach House in Milford, Connecticut. The Beach House follows their own philosophy of fresh is best, with an exquisite cuisine of natural hormone-free beef, organic chicken, and the freshest of fish. The charming Oak Bar and the Chef's Exhibition Kitchen invite everyone to enjoy the delightful atmosphere and the flirtatious views of the Sound. Come to the Beach House in Milford, Connecticut. You never know who may be waiting inside.
Hi, this is Bill Schweitzer. You know, when you can't get to a game, listen on AM 1220 WQUN or on any mobile device by downloading the Quinnipiac Bobcats app and then clicking on radio. Or the TuneIn Radio app and search for WQUN. They're both free. And after the game, listen to the Morrow Motors post-game show when you're driving back down the hill. Hear comments from a coach, highlights from the game, and pearls of wisdom from Bill Mecca.
Back at the TD Bank Sports Center, Bob Mortali and Bob Tipson. When Bill Mecca gives you pearls of wisdom, we'll do our best to give you cubic zirconia in place of Bill, who's on the TV side with Bill Schweitzer tonight. Quinnipiac, I guess, in a little bit of a feeling out process, trying to get their flow back and off to a little bit of a slow start, despite the fact they're leading 6-4, only 2 of 8 from the field.
Yeah, and I'm surprised that the goal rush came in so quickly. I mean, it was 3 minutes, and all of a sudden the starting five was on the bench. Maybe she's trying to wake them up, saying, look it. Just because you're the starting five doesn't mean you're going to be out there long minutes and not doing anything. And you're getting some defensive pressure on people and making, you know, good decisions with the ball in terms of shots. And so maybe it's a wake-up call.
Plus, she got away from the goal rush for about 3 or 4 games and started literally subbing 1 or 2 players at a time, not going to 5 at a time. It's Earl, the forecourt for the Bobcats. Back to live action. Man defense by the Hawks. Pass to the left for Napolitano. On the wing, one dribbles, cross-court feed Martucci. Pulls up, inside pass to Warner. It's knocked away by the Hawks. Taken off by Meza. Meza, far sideline, goes past Martucci. Through the foul line. Kicks it back to the left corner for Bepko. Now on top, Meza brings it back out to the logo. The 5 starters coming off the bench for the Bobcats. They'll go in at the next whistle. On the floor, Bepko bounces one to the right for Boltrin. Guarded closely by Martucci. Shot clock at 13. Blue pass inside, knocked away by Ostergaard. Controlled by Bepko. Shot clock at 8. Right side pass. Meza on the drive. Triple team. And the officials that stay right here is going to be a blocking foul inside against any one of 3 Quinnipiac players. And it looks like it's going to be against Napolitano.
And now we have the 5 subs coming in. That time, Hartford really had nothing going. It kind of fumbled the ball a couple times. Tried a dribble drive, and none of that was working. And luckily, he got bailed out by the official on a call.
Napolitano's first foul, team's 3rd. The 5 Quinnipiac starters back in the game. Hartford with the basketball. Boltrin to the left side for Bepko on the drive. The bounce pass inside is loose on the floor. Picked up by Boltrin. Tries a 3-pointer. That's around the rim, no good. McQueen with easy rebound. Great box out. Any outlets for Abshire. Blue to the forecourt. Right side pass. Cannon on the wing. Another 3-point attempt off the front rim, no good. Guastella inside, and she's fouled on a putback attempt. She'll go to the free throw stripe.
Well, the good thing about on a fast break, getting the 3-point shot off is that your big guy, your big players are coming down and they're getting your offensive rebounds on the weak side. So if she misses, you're going to have the bigger player standing there getting a rebound and a putback.
Alana Gilbert's 2nd personal, team's 3rd. Guastella shooting the free throw in the air. Good. Some substitutions for Hartford. Caitlin Skinner's into the game along with Morgan Lum. And our Alyssa Englert once again, Skinner, 5'10" sophomore from Homer City, Pennsylvania. So Guastella, one more coming. For Sam, it's good.
I'll tell you what, she looks really good on the foul line. Nice follow-through.
And it's 8-4, Bobcats by 4. Lum in the backcourt, working on Abshire, brings it across. Now to the far corner, it's Englert. Puts it on the dribble, the bounce to the low post, inside for Gilbert, kicks it back to the corner for Skinner for a 3 from the left side. That's off the rim, no good. Rebound, knocked to the floor, a scramble forward. It's picked up by Hartford as Lum controls, finds Englert on the drive. Left side of the lane, it's blocked by McQueen. A 2nd shot is blocked by Guastella, and then Abshire controlled the basketball. Hartford player knocked down, and a foul is going to be called.
2 great blocks that time, you know. You really contested both shots, and they really didn't have a chance to score either one of those.
Gilbert's 3rd personal foul, team's 4th. And she's replaced immediately by Taylor Clark. So again, I'm going to go with the pressure in the backcourt as Abshire works on Lum. She falls down across the way, and a foul's going to be called. Foul against Hartford for a push. Lum's first, team's fifth.
I don't know what kind of angle the official on this side saw. I mean, literally 40 feet away, the official was literally 5 feet in front of her on that side. So I don't know if that's a good call or a bad call.
8-4, Bobcats by four. Abshire on the wing to the right side. Guastella on top, left side Martin. Drives to the baseline, pulls up at the low post, needs some help. Back for Guastella, who had her heel on the sideline when she caught the pass. So it's Hartford ball.
I think Jasmine that time kind of premeditated that drive. She was going to catch it, try to take it to the basket, and then picked it up rather than maybe dribbling it back out.
Angler dribbling with the right hand at the logo. Right side pass for Lum. Working on the left side to Abshire. Her pass knocked away. Boo controls far sideline, and it's a race for the basket. Abshire going one-on-one down the lane. Scoop layup around her. No good. She gets her own rebound on the right end line to Cannon for a jumper for three. That's off the back iron. No good. Guastella back for Cannon. On top, Abshire from downtown. It's good.
Pretty good ball movement at that time on a rebound, an offensive rebound. You know, two passes, and you get an open jump shot at the top of the key.
Getting that second and third opportunity is beneficial for the Bobcats, and sloppy defense that time by Hartford. Timeout called by Jen Rosati across the way with 13 minutes, 52 seconds remaining in the first half. Quinnipiac now with the 11-4 lead thanks to the bomb from downtown for Abshire, who comes into this game. Now she's 5-12 from the outside for three-point range, and she's averaging, as we mentioned, a pregame show in double figures. Player was always been a pass first guard in her past, but now she's taking more opportunities to take the shots and get the points to go with her assist totals. She's also not a decent rebounder for a guard. Some of her career numbers, if she puts it all together, she could be a triple double player here someday.
Well, you know, I think the thing is too, when she got the rebound, the second, you know, the one she missed, she didn't try to put it back up. She threw it back out, then reset and got a good jump shot at the top of the key.
Pass is stolen by Abshire and inbounds to Guastella from downtown.
Again, nice pass that time by Boo.
So she does it all, and it's now a 14-4 lead on the other end of pass. Down court and a layup by Taylor Clark to make it 14-6. But the Bobcats now up by 8, 13-35 remaining in the first half. Abshire to the top of the circle, gives to Guastella. Couple of dribbles to the left, now to Martin. Martin on the left wing on top for Abshire. Looking for movement from her teammates. Bounces one to the foul line for Guastella. She faces the basket, shot clock at 12. Guastella needs some help, dribbles one, stops. From Martin, 8 seconds on the shot clock. Jazz dribbles to her right, down the lane, right side. Layup attempt off the side of the backboard. McQueen fouls and scores, and she's fouled.
Again, you know, when you're playing her, and she's at the top of the key anywhere, and a shot goes up, you better put a body on it, because she does go to the rim, and she tries to rebound every missed shot.
Alyssa Engler with the foul, her first, team six. First bucket of the game for Brittany, makes it 16-6. I'll tell you what, you talk about getting the garbage points or the garbage rebounding. That's been her bread and butter, and she kind of almost thrives on the physical play inside.
You know, and everybody calls that those are garbage points. Those are outworking somebody points. I don't know if there's such a thing as garbage points. Points are points.
Well, you got to get your hands dirty on plays like that when two girls are shoving you from the back on the rebound attempt.
That's why it's called outworking them.
Okay. It's 17-6 on the three-point play from McQueen. The Bobcats in front with 12:55 to go in the first half. Hartford basketball. Clark jumper from the right side. Off the rim, no good. Tipped around. Recovered by Skinner on the baseline. Looks for help. Sends it back out for Clark. Out on top for Lum. Lum working on Martin. Goes into the foul line. Back for Caitlin Skinner. Right side jumper is good from downtown. A three-pointer.
She brought rain on that one. She threw that one up almost to the top of the building here.
17-9. Bobcats by 8. 12:33 remaining in the first half. Guastella on the left wing. Near sideline for Martin. Dribbles to her right to the foul line. Bounce one back out for Abshire. One dribbles to the left from Martin. Splits two defenders. Goes into the lane. Layup attempt is partially deflected by Taylor Clark. And Clark controls. Outlets for Lum. Long quickly down court for Sherelle Morba. Had it intercepted by Abshire. Another steal for Boo. Boo to the forecourt. Waits for her teammates. Back for Guastella. Top of the three-point arc. Gives it back to Boo. Abshire faces the basket with 12:05 to go in the first half. Bounces one to the left for Cannon. Looks to the left corner for Martin. The boop inside for McQueen. Has a step and banks it in.
Great post-up move that time by McLean, and a great pass by Jasmine.
The lead is double digits once again in 19-9. Into the forecourt for Hartford. Moore at the foul line. Jarrell Moore fakes the jumper, has to get let go of the basketball. She recovers, though, and throws the pass to the right corner for Clark. Away from the play, foul's going to be called against Quinnipiac. Looks like they got McQueen. That'll be Brittany's first personal foul. Team's fourth. McQuain talks it over with the official while the rest of the players go to the bench. We have a timeout on the floor. 11:42 remaining in the first half. Quinnipiac 19, Hartford 9 on the Bobcats Radio Network.
Hello, I'm Kyle DeLucia, owner of K&J Tree Removal. In the past, we have been inundated with high winds, ice, and snowstorms that have caused damage to trees, homes, and power lines. Be prepared before the next storm strikes. K&J can remove, prune, and even cable your trees. K&J is currently running a special. $600 off any tree job. Call K&J Tree Removal at 203-248-TREE. That's 203-248-8733. Or visit us on the web at KJ Tree Removal.
Has life passed you by? With work, home, bills, responsibilities, how about a break for you? This is Dan Darling. I want you to be inspired today through coffeebreakforthesoul.com. You can read a text, watch a video, even journal your own thoughts or share a thought. So come and be inspired today through coffeebreakforthesoul.com. Subscribe today.
A little bit of a run for the Bobcats since the last media timeout, 13-5 since the 16-minute mark. Bobcats with a 10-point lead and are finding more success, especially on the inside aspect of their game.
Yeah, you know, again, the spacing is really important if you're going to throw the ball into the paint area. You can't get bunched up in there because it really is hard for a post player then to make a move. Like that last pass, everybody on the opposite side was at the three-point arc or above the foul line, and now Brittany gets it in there. She's got no pressure in terms of a double team. She just dropped step and laid it in, and a great, again, a very good pass by Jasmine Martin to give her a little floater there.
Plus, the Bobcat defense has forced Hartford to 8 turnovers in the first 8 minutes. They're looking at a 40 turnover night to keep that pace up.
You know, we've scored 8 points off turnovers, which is, you know, that's 50% of those turnovers you're getting a point out of.
Engler to inbound to the end line to our right. Needs some help. Throws it way out to the logo. It's caught by Skinner. Kaitlin Skinner finds on the left Engler. The blue pass inside for Moore. Deflected away off the hand of Cameron Martin. The second five is back in for the Bobcats as Trish made the 5-on-5 swap during the timeout.
You know, they played a lot of games, so maybe it's just a case where she wants to give people rest.
Looking for help on the inbounds pass goes to Moore. Left low post on the dry. Scoop shot is blocked by Ostergaard. It goes out of bounds. Another opportunity for the Hawks, but another shot blocked by the Bobcats.
Well, they're putting a lot of defensive pressure on people, and I think that that's, you know, especially the post people, they're not letting them get in clean shots in the post area.
Engler throws in, fakes a pass, needs help, can't find anywhere to throw to initially. Now it's Cheryl Moore has to leap to catch the pass, top of the three-point circle. On the left side now it's Engler. Moving on Martucci, spinning left of the lane, out on top for Skinner, right side, Mesa on the drive of the baseline, back to Englert, left wing, dribbles to the foul line, bounce pass inside for Moore, pump fake blocked from behind by Ostergaard again, it's recovered by Warner, Quinnipiac ball, 19-9 to lead for the Bobcats, Shayna Earl dribbles behind her back at the half-court line, now stops top of the arc, left side for Warner, looking on the cut for Martucci, splits two defenders on the drive, little hook shot is no good, Warner though, in the rebounding area, gets it on the end line, they work it on top for Earl at the foul line, and away from the plate. No, traveling is the call against Shayna. It'll be Hartford ball.
And Martucci again did everything but finish the play. She did a nice job of coming to a jump stop, step through, puts it up there, and just doesn't finish. So they'll be okay as this game goes on. You know, they'll be able to finish some of these and get a little bit of a run going.
Amber Bepko back in the Hartford lineup, 5'9 junior from Guilford, who played her high school ball at Mercy High. Hartford with the basketball, Engler against Martucci on the left wing, dribbles by the Bobcat bench, cross the way, stops her dribble, needs some help, sends one back out for Bepko. Bepko one dribbles, right side for Mesa. Kicks it back for Taylor Clark, long jumper, two-point range, no good off the rim. Rebound, though, taken off the floor by Alyssa Reeves. Dribbles to the left corner, now stops, got it closely by Warner. Faces the basket, tied up, it's loose, controlled by Napolitano. And Shayna Earl has the ball at the five starters, go to the scorer's table. Earl, right wing, pass rolling is deflected by recovered. Napolitano's jumper is good.
Oh, great shot that time. I really like her jump shot. You know, she's one of those that has a nice spin on the ball.
21-9, Bobcats by a dozen. On the other end, Reeves in the low post, partially deflected on her shot, but the ball goes out of bounds. They say last touch by the Hawks.
I think they're having trouble in there. I think I would try to maybe move out a little bit. As soon as they get down in that post, they've had, what, three blocks or four blocks in a row now?
At least.
You know, and now you may want to take a few jump shots.
5 blocks for the Bobcats so far tonight. A lot of long arms on that Quinnipiac front line against a shorter Hartford squad. Abshire in the backcourt. Left side pass for Guastella. She moves it to the left wing of the forecourt. Now stops a dribble. Gives it back to Boo. Approaching the 10-minute mark of the first half. Bobcats lead 21-9. Abshire looking for the cutter. Finds Cannon on a bounce pass. Now inside for McQueen, facing the basket in the lane. Back on the right wing for Abshire. Dribbles to the foul line. On top, Cannon. Hands it off to Abshire. Shot clock at 5. Boo doesn't realize it yet. Now drives past the foul line. Running one-hander off the backboard. No good off the rim. And play continues as it's taken off by Meza. Meza into the forecourt. The feed inside for Rees. Working against Guastella. Double team in the low post. Back outside. A long jumper by Clark is good.
I think that's their best offense. Get it in there. Let everybody collapse down and then throw it back out.
21-11. The lead is 10 for the Bobcats. Abshire bumping with Bepko on the right wing. And a foul is going to be against Bepko. That'll be her first. Seventh team foul on Hartford. And a substitution, Latrice Hall. Her first appearance, 5'11 freshman from Buffalo, replaces Alyssa Reeves. So it's Abshire at the foul line. 72% coming into this game. Free throw in the air, good. Made the two critical free throws in that close victory against American not too long ago. Although she was over 6 from the field. After the game, she talked about missing all her shots from the field, even though she had multiple assists and she had the clutch free throws. She makes them both here, and it's now 23-11. Bobcats by a dozen. In the forecourt, Engler to the foul line. Right side for Clark. Has it knocked away by Cannon, but able to recover. Work it to the left side. Meza, three-pointer. Left side is good.
Well, it's starting to heat up a little bit more from the outside. And you know, Quinnipiac, I think, has got to get out there and start contesting those shooters.
23-14, Bobcats by 9. Martin goes left baseline, spins in the low post, working on Meza, goes back to McQueen to the foul line, is it knocked away from behind, able to recover, finds Abshire for a three-pointer, that's off the rim, no good. Guastella with a rebound, and she kicks it back out to the top of the three-point arc. Left side, Martin pulls a trigger from downtown, that's off the rim, and no good as well. Rebounded off the floor by Englert. Hartford on the move. Englert to the forecourt, met by Abshire at the foul line, stops her dribble, spins in the right side of the lane, gives it back out to Meza. Meza drives right baseline to the low post, double team, inside pass stolen by McQueen. Gets it out to Abshire. No numbers though, just 2-on-4. Pass to the front side to Cannon. On top, Guastella from 3 is good.
She didn't hesitate either. She kind of got herself ready to shoot that, and she put her hand up. Give me the ball because I'm going to hit this one.
She has 8 points, 2 3-pointers for Sam. It's 26-14. Bobcats again by 12. Meza in the forecourt with 8:14 to go in the first half. Near sideline for Clark. Falls down, tied up with McQueen. The whistle for the tie possession. Arrow, though, in favor of Hartford. And the second five's back in for Quinnipiac. And for Hartford, Morgan Lum returns. And she's also joined by Sherelle Moore, the junior from Bridgeport, who played her high school ball at Kobe Cathedral. Bobcats lead 26-14. 12 points has been the Vegas lead so far tonight for the Bobcats. Inbounds pass to Engler, top of the circle, working on Martucci. Moves to down the left front of the foul line. Stops a dribble. Out on top for Hall. Hall dribbles a couple of times with the right hand. Gives on the curl to Meza. Double team. Finds Lum to the left corner for Engler. Drives left baseline. Shot clock violation. Quinnipiac ball.
Yeah, that's the one as a coach you really get upset with, that nobody was paying attention to the shot clock.
And usually you hear the bench count it down. We didn't hear a countdown from the Hartford bench either. Timeout on the floor, 7:53 to go in the first half. Bobcats in front, 26-14. We'll be right back.
Get your coffee from the folks that know coffee inside and out. For over 60 years, we've kept America running with our dedication to serving the freshest cup of coffee. Dunkin' Donuts. America runs on Dunkin'. You want your coffee quick, freshly brewed, and ground from only the finest beans. Make the most of your day with the fresh ground taste of America's favorite cup of joe. At Dunkin' Donuts, you can do it. Dunkin' Donuts Coffee. America runs on Dunkin'.
Hey, what are you drinking?
I'm drinking Dunkin'. 4 mornings a week, I try to get a run in. And I know that I'm supposed to drink a glass of water after my run, but there's the Dunkin' Donuts. Right on the way home.
America runs on Dunkin' Coffee.
Hey, what are you drinking?
I'm drinking Dunkin'. When you get that first cup of coffee in the morning, it starts your day off right. You know, pre-coffee, you should keep your distance. Once I have my Dunkin', I'm all good.
America runs on Dunkin' Coffee.
Bob Mortali, Bob Tipson, live at the TD Bank Sports Center. Quinnipiac with a 12-point lead at 26-14. And nice defensive pressure by the Quinnipiac women tonight. They're causing all sorts of havoc for the Hartford Hawks on all ends of the floor.
Yeah, and Trish is doing a good job. I think she's getting fresh legs in there, and I think she's, you know, I think she feels like this is a team she can beat. So she really wants to wear them down, and she put a lot of pressure on them. you know, they have 11 turnovers already. They average 18 a game. So this one might go into 25, 26 turnovers for the ball game.
Plus now 12-plus minutes and 7 steals for the Bobcat women. They had 16 against Hartford last year. Of course, many of those were from Felicia Barron, who's no longer here. But, again, you got them a little off their snide in a way. They kind of, just a mental mistake of not knowing the shot clock was running down. It just kind of tells you where their head is at right now.
Yeah, I think that they're, you know, they weren't paying attention, that's for sure. Even the coaching staff over there wasn't paying attention.
Earl with the basketball on the left wing of the floor. Corb with a second five in. Bounces one to her right from Martucci on her initial move. She's bumped by Morgan Lum. And that's Lum's second, team's eighth.
You know, Martucci is going to be a good player here. She redshirted last year, but she was playing every day in practice, and she was probably, you know, she was playing against Felicia Barron. So I think she's got a lot of bounce in her, you know, in her game, and she's quick with the ball. She defends really well, and she's got some pretty good shooting ability as she makes the first foul shot. So I think she's going to be a really good player for Quinnipiac in the years to come.
Nice rotation on the foul shot as well. Came in averaging a little less than 3 points a game in limited minutes. Second free throw is good as well. And the lead is now 28-14. Bobcats way in front as we hit the 7:40 mark of the first half. Engler dribbling along the far sideline, covered by Martucci. Stops in front of the Bobcat bench. Needs some help. Cross-court feed for Hall. Patrice Hall dribbles, guarded by Napolitano on the curl. The gift to Meza. The blue pass inside. A lieutenant from Moore knocked away, controlled by Napolitano. Outlets for Earl. Earl in the near sideline dribbles to the top of the arc. Right side for Napolitano. In front of the bench, the Hartford bench, it's Ostergaard working on the right baseline. Cross-court feed from Martucci. Pulls up left side jumper from about 14. No good off the rim. Rebound tipped around, controlled by Latrice Hall. Gets it out to Meza. Hartford on the move. Meza pass to Lobo in the forecourt. Stops at the foul line to the right side. The pass for Englert. Pulls up. 15-footer is good.
Yeah, nice pump fake that time. You know, got Martucci to go by her a little bit as she took the one dribble and was able to shoot the shot with no contest.
Quinnipiac leads 28-16. Earl, forecourt, on the left wing, takes Engler out with her. Left side pass from Martucci. Left side jumper is good.
Again, I like the way she's playing. You know, she's playing very good defense, and she's really shooting the ball pretty well.
That's 4 points for Martucci, 30-16. Bobcats in the lead, 6.5 to go in the first half. Martucci guarding Engler at the half-court line. Engler dribbling to the Bobcat bench with the left hand. Continues to dribble. Barks directions at her teammates. She moves to the left baseline. Double team. Bounces one to Mazer, right corner. She drives baseline. Double team, low post. Pass intercepted by Martucci. He gets to Earl. Earl working it across the logo into the forecourt against Meza. Left side pass. Ostergaard takes her time. Three-pointer in the air. Around the rim, no good. It's taken off by Sherelle Moore. Moore looks down for Englert. Englert passed the logo where she's met by Martucci. Gets a pick from Moore. Dribbles to the right wing and stops. Left side pass for Boltron. Janice Boltron to the foul line. Bounces one for Latrice Hall for a long two-pointer. It's no good off the rim. Great box out by Warner. She takes the rebound and gives to Earl. Shayna dribbling past us into the forecourt with 5:45 to go first half. Right corner pass. Napolitano fakes. Now the three-pointer in the air. Off the rim. No good. Ostergaard fights for the rebound. She bumps with Moore on the inside. Looks like the foul's going to be called on Nikki.
Nikki, I don't think she knows she ever fouls. You know, she bumped into her, and then she kind of looked at the official like, that was a foul?
Maybe last year it wasn't. This year it is. I don't know. Ostergaard's first personal, team's fifth. The starting five back in for Quinnipiac with 5:40 to go in the first half. Cannon, Martin, McQueen, Guastella, and Abshire. So it's Hartford basketball at the logo. Alyssa Englert bounces one for Bepko. Right side pass for Taylor Clark on the wing, guarded closely by Guastella, who's all over her. Long arms in front of her face. Needs some help. Finally, a five-second call. Great defense by Guastella.
Well, not only great defense by Guastella, but everybody else really defended their player and would not let a pass be thrown to any of the other opponents.
So Samuel inbound, just in front of the TV crew. Mr. Schweitzer and Mr. Mecca cross the way with 5:23 to go in the first half. It passes the backcourt for Abshire. She'll walk it across the logo. Stops her dribble, finds McQueen, right wing, on top Martin. Left side Abshire, guarded by Bepko. Pump fakes the pass, now finds Cannon straight away. To the right side, Martin moves to the right corner, working on Boltron. Out on top McQueen, shot clock at 10. Pass to the left for Cannon, on the drive, triple team, goes up against the trees, no good on the layup attempt. It's taken up off the floor by Bepko. Outlets for Englert. Dribbles to the right wing. Cross-court feed, Boltrin. Inside pass for Alyssa Rees. She's guarded by Guastella. Dribbling with the right hand. Into the lane. Clobbers McQueen. Offensive foul is going to be called. It's basically she lowered her shoulder almost like a football block and plowed into Brittany.
Which, you know, and there were three defensive players standing right there in the paint. So somebody was open, but she wasn't going to see any of that. She was going to score that basket no matter what.
I kidded Brittany in an interview we did for the Missouri State game. I said, you're on the floor at least three or four times a game. She says, well, the trainers do a great job of keeping me in shape. McQueen gets the feed in the low post, faces the basket. Right-handed shot is in and out. Rebound, batted around, controlled by Bebko. Outlets for Engler. Bobcats lead 30-16. In the forecourt, Engler working on Martin. Stops her dribble, hands it off to Boltrin. Dribbling to her left on Martin, hands it off on the curl to Bebko. Now back out for Engler at the logo with 4:22 to go in the first half. Engler bounces one to the right for Bebko. Left side pass for Boltrin. The feed inside, knocked away by McQueen, who banks it off a player's foot, a Hartford player's foot. I don't know if she got the call or not.
No, she actually was stepping out of bounds, and that's what they called.
And Latrice Hall's back in for Hartford, replacing Alyssa Reeves. 4:14 to go, first half. Bobcats up 30-16. It'll be Bebko to throw in right in front of the scorer's table. Need some help, looking for movement. Pass deflected out of bounds by McQueen, intended for Hall. So Hartford will do it again. Shot clock with five, by the way. And I think the Hartford coaches just realized that. Now a horn is blown across the way, and Hartford coaches are off the bench. I wonder if they're wondering about the shot clock situation. There's five on a shot clock, 4:10 in the game clock.
Well, I think what they're saying, what they're probably saying is Brittany had possession of the ball and then threw it in, so maybe they want a new clock. I don't think they're going to get one, though.
Well, there's a replay screen ready to be activated on demand. The game is, again, on television tonight, so it'll be interesting to see. In fact, they call for video replay to make that determination. They're going to set the clock to 4:13, so the game clock probably lost some time. So they'll put it back to 4:13 and put the shot clock back to 8 seconds. And they didn't need a video replay to do it either. So it didn't take too long. We're back to action as Bebko inbounds in front of the Bobcat bench across the way. Pass goes inside to Clark. Clark hands it back to Bebko on the curl. Lost control of the dribble on the near sideline. Then recovers with the shot clock winding down. And she just gave up. She saw it at one and said, hell, heck with that, and will take the violation.
Yeah, might as well have taken a timeout, you know, and she did. She literally, she almost gave the ball to Quinnipiac.
That's what the coaches call bad body language. And it's something they don't want to see. But it's Bobcats with a 14-point lead. McQueen at the right wing. Facing the basket, less than 4 minutes to go in the first half. To Guastella, left corner, 4-3, a little too much juice that time. Abshire on the end line with a rebound, able to save it. And then a foul called on the pass as Brittany McQueen goes down. And they're going to call Brittany on a foul. That'll be Brittany's first, check that, second personal foul. And team six, timeout on the floor, 3:49 to go in the first half. The Bobcats in control for the moment at 30-16 on the Bobcats Radio Network.
After nearly 50 years serving the community with all your lighting needs, the Lamp Shop will be closing their doors forever on December 28th. I'm Jackie Kaywood, and I want to thank all of you who have supported the Lamp Shop. You have not just been customers, you have been my friends as well. Throughout the years, I have offered great specials on all our beautiful lighting merchandise, but never have the specials
been this
spectacular.
Now you can go to the beach any time of the year.
Now through December 28th, I'm holding a retirement sale with an additional 50%
fresh
off
is
all
best
merchandise,
with exquisite cuisine, natural hormone-free beef,
the
organic
Lamp
chicken,
Shop,
the freshest of fish.
Avenue,
the charming
Indiana,
Oak Bar,
Tuesday
the chef's exhibition
Saturday.
Kitchen, and everyone to enjoy the delightful atmosphere.
The Lamp Shop will be closing their doors forever on December 28th.
Come to the beach house
Jackie
in Milford, Connecticut.
At a retirement sale and take an additional 50% off all merchandise, excluding lampshades, parts, and repairs.
Bob Mortali and Bob Tipson at the TD Bank Sports Center. Quinnipiac in command, 30-16. And we're seeing what happens when a team plays a lot of young players, freshmen and sophomore, seeing a lot of playing time, a lot of minutes, and the growing pains are pretty evident here in this Hartford ball club.
No question about it. I mean, yet again, that big, 16 turnovers, of which have produced 15 points for the Bobcats. I mean, that's a telling sign that you're not dealing with veteran players out there. It's kind of like... You got to have them understand that possession of the ball is really, really important, and they're just kind of flinging it around. And some of that has to do with the fact that Quinnipiac is really playing pretty good defense on them. When they pick the ball up, one, they're really pressuring the passer, but more importantly, they're really denying everybody on the floor. So your passes are like 20 feet, you know, passes, and we're getting deflections, and we're really making it hard for them to run their offense.
Again, the Hawks have not scored more than 59 points in any game this year. They average only 49. No player averages in double figures. In their last game against St. Francis of Brooklyn, shot just 21% in the second half and scored only 16 points in the final 20 minutes. So this is not something new that Hartford has come up with against the Bobcats. They've been facing this kind of situation all season long so far. Some pressure by the Bobcats in the backcourt as Bepko looks to throw in, sets it up for Boltron. Boltron gets around Abshire, dribbles across the far sideline into the forecourt. Gets it back for Englert. Englert guarded by Cannon. A pass to the foul line is caught there by Hall. Face of the basket, goes down the lane, bumps with Martin. Shot goes around the rim and in, and the bucket for the Hawks.
Yeah, if she wouldn't have fallen, I don't think she'd have been able to get the shot off. Maybe she just should have stood up.
First bucket by Hall. It's 30-18. On the other end, Martin lost control of the ball. It's taken off by Hartford. Bepko at the foul line. Bossa went to the right for a wide open Latrice Hall, who lays it in.
Yeah, pretty nice 3-on-2 break that time. And, you know, a really nice decision in terms of making that bounce pass to her for the layup.
And Trish Fabry was not happy with that brief sequence there. So she took the subs out, put the five starters. I checked that. Put the second five back in for the starters with the timeout call. 3:17 to go in the first half. Still a comfortable lead for the Bobcats at 30-20. But Trish wants them to stay focused and keep their minds on the intensity level that they've had. Because once you get like about 14, 15 point lead, there's that subtle tendency involuntarily to back off just a little bit. You can't have that.
Well, and I think the more important part is, you know, most teams, most players don't back off at the offensive end because they really want to score and they want to, you know, they want to run their offense. But the last two possessions down the court, it almost has been two forced shots, trying to go one-on-one, maybe figuring, you know, we got the lead, I can do something here where, you know, I can make a bad shot or I can take a bad shot. And I think that's what Trish is a little bit upset with.
Inbounds to Warner, gives it back to Ostergaard in the backcourt, and the initial pressure is dropped off as Ostergaard hands it off to Earl in the forecourt. Earl guarded closely by Bepko, dribbling with the right hand, top of the three-point arc. They get it to Warner. Warner from the foul line moves it beyond the three-point arc, right side for Earl. The pass inside to Ostergaard, knocked out of bounds. Last touch by Clark of Hartford. It's Bobcat ball.
Well, I don't think she was ready to catch that ball in the low post, and she threw it so low that she really never got possession of it.
Inbounds to Warner, spins right low post, shot no good off the rim, rebounded by Hall. Hall looks for Englert. Englert crosses the logo into the forecourt with 2:50 to go in the first half. Bobcats lead 30-20. Latrice Hall at the foul line, goes back out for Englert. Now back to Hall, facing Warner, dribbles a couple times, kicks it back out to the near sideline. A long bomb is good by Shanice Boltron.
And that was a long ball that time. She was about 6 feet beyond the arc.
All of a sudden, 7-0 run for the Hawks. It's 30-23 with 2.5 to go in the first half. Ostergaard left wing, facing Clark, dribbles with the right hand, stops, needs help. Pass deflected off the hands of Bepko, out of bounds as Earl races for it. The official says last touch by Hartford. Now Boo Abshire is in, and she takes out just Earl. So just a one sub sequence there for Trish Fabry. She wants Boo's leadership on the floor at the point. Ostergaard inbounds to Abshire, who dribbles with the left hand, working toward us with 2:16 to go first half. Shot clock at 9. Bouncing over Martucci at the foul line. Splits two defenders. Little 8-footer off the back iron, no good. Rebounded to Sherelle Moore. Outlets for Bepko. She moves to the forecourt on Martucci. Circus pass to the left corner for Boltron from downtown. She did it again.
Good dribble penetration that time. A little help from the weak side, from the wing side, and she gets an open shot.
It's a 10-0 run, 30-26. Bobcats by 4. Napolitano from downtown. She
and
buries
fouled.
It. And she's fouled. She's got a chance for a 4-point play.
She didn't hesitate either. I think she was zeroed in on that one, and great jump shot, and she gets fouled on it, so get a chance to get a 4.
She's got a smooth stroke, I'll grant you that. We've seen that several occasions in the past year plus. I got to back up and look at the replay on the TV monitors, and that was a pretty bomb from downtown. Looking at it again, Napolitano just drew the defender out to her, and she drew the foul. So Napolitano with an opportunity for a 4-point play, which stopped the 10-0 run. Free throw in the air, off the rim, got the friendly bounce, it's good. So now fresh bodies for the Bobcats. Joining Abshire is Guastella, Warner, Cannon, and Martin with 1:49 to go. It's 34-26. Bobcats by 8. Hartford with the ball, still in the backcourt. It's Englert working on Martin. She crosses the midcourt line. Pass caught at the far sideline by Boltron. Front of the Bobcat bench. Out on top for Moore. Right side Clark on the wing, guarded by Guastella. On top for Englert once again. Shot clock at 10 to Moore. Foul line jumper. Good.
Wow, nice little step back that time. And actually, good defense by Quinnipiac. She stepped back to take that shot to create some space.
Buried it from 18 feet. It's 34-28. Bobcats by 6. Cannon, far sideline to the wing for Abshire. Back to Ellen and away from the play. Foul's going to be called. Vicious, they stay right here as Kathleen Lonergan makes the call against the Hawks. Sherelle Moore's foul, her first. With 1:12 to go in the first half, Bobcats lead at 34-28. Warner last year nearly a double-double against the Hawks, 10 points and 9 rebounds. Free throw in the air, good.
Yeah, you want to finish this half, you know, with the ball coming down, because you're going to get the ball if you're Quinnipiac to start the second half. So you want to make a little run right here if you can.
Second one is good as well. Cammy shooting 85% from the line this season. It's 36-28. Bobcats by 8 with 109 to go in the first half. Englert in the forecourt against Martin, dribbling with the right hand. The pass for Clark right at the foul line. Guarded closely by Guastella. To get to Englert. Pass inside from Moore. It's stolen by Abshire. Boo on the move. Racing past the logo into the forecourt. To Cannon, right wing, inside, low post. It's Guastella right of the lane. Double team. Needs some help. Got hit in the mouth. Cross court fast now to Martin. Martin on the drive. Left side jumper from 16 is no good. A little short off the rim. Taken off by the Hawks. Englert into the forecourt with 40 seconds to go. Englert to the foul line. Left of the lane. Needs some help. Spins. Gets it back out on the drive. It is Meza with a short shot that's off the mark. Goes out of bounds. Last touch by the Hawks.
Well, that time I expected Hartford really to try to get one off quickly, because they would have been playing 2-for-1. You know, with the shot clock at 30, you would have got another possession, maybe with about 8 or 9 seconds left, where you could have scored a second basket.
Inbounds to Abshire. Working on Meza. Across the way, there's a collision, and a blocking foul is going to be called on Meza right in front of Coach Fabry. So Deanna Meza with her first personal foul. So in essence, with the foul call here, they will get the 2-for-1. They will get that one extra possession.
Yeah, but unfortunately, they didn't make the first one.
Well, that's their problem.
It's 1-for-1 now.
That's their problem. Abshire at the line already, 2 of 2 from the line, 5 points tonight. First free throw, good. Again, among the nation's leaders in assists. And a whistle. Shayna Earl will go in for Abshire at the next opportunity. Abshire's at the line with one free throw coming, 29 seconds remaining in the first half. A 9-point Bobcat lead. Free throw is good. Boo with 7, and she goes to the bench, replaced by Earl. So it's Hartford ball. Meza gets the inbounds pass and gives it back to Englert. Englert's met at the logo by Martin. Dribbles with the right hand, moves to her right, bumps momentarily with Martin. Pass to the right for Moore. Near sideline with 19 seconds going to half. Shot clock is off. Pass to the half-court line, partially deflected by Guastella, recovered by Clark. Left side pass for Meza. Meza moving to her right around the pick with 10 seconds to go. The pass to Moore at the foul line. Ball knocked away by Warner. Recovered by Meza on the baseline on the drive. And a foul's going to be called with 3.5 seconds to go. The foul on Quinnipiac.
You played great defense right up until that last play. And, you know, she gets by somebody and then you foul her. You know, just try to stay in front of her. Make sure she doesn't get an easy shot off. And stop the shot. Stop the clock. Excuse me.
Guastella's foul. Her first. Just the 7th team foul for Quinnipiac. Now send Meza to the foul line, a 91% foul shooter right now. Counting that one, she's 23 of 25 on the season. Earl comes out, Abshire returns for the final 3.5 seconds. Second free throw by Meza, it's good as well.
Well, let's see how fast we can get the ball down the court.
38-30. On the inbounds pass to Abshire. Racing to the half court line. A collision. Two players go down, and the horn goes off as Abshire got a little tangled up with Alyssa Englert. The horn went off. No shot. No harm. No foul. And we come to the end of the first half. The Bobcats withstood the little 10-0 run on the part of the Hawks and go back to a little bit of a comfort zone going to the locker room up by 8.
Well, I think that we kind of got out of whack there for a little while, and they hit a couple threes. We didn't go out and close out on the three-point shooter, which got them really right back in the ballgame. And then we really didn't get any good shots, the last minute and 15 seconds. So You know, we got to clean that up a little bit. And I think Trish is happy to be ahead. I don't think she's real happy, because I think she probably feels she should be 15, 16 points ahead. Where Jen Rosati, I think, is probably happy she's where she's at, because, you know, they're still turning the ball over a lot and they're not really getting good shots.
We are at halftime at the TD Bank Sports Center. Quinnipiac with the 38-30 lead on Hartford. We'll be right back.
How did I get here? Dumb luck? Or good decisions? About marriage? Children? Money? About tomorrow?
Who matters most to you says the most about you. At MassMutual, we're owned by our policy owners, and they matter most to us. Learn more at massmutual.com/mutuality. Contact us at info@charteroakfinancial.com or visit us at charteroakfinancial.com.
Get your coffee from the folks that know coffee inside and out. For over 60 years, we've kept America running with our dedication to serving the freshest cup of coffee. Dunkin' Donuts. America runs on Dunkin'. You want your coffee quick, freshly brewed, and ground from only the finest beans. Make the most of your day with the fresh ground taste of America's favorite cup of joe. At Dunkin' Donuts, you can do it. Dunkin' Donuts coffee. America runs on Dunkin'.
Hey, what are you drinking?
I'm drinking Dunkin'. Four mornings a week, I try to get a run in. And I know that I'm supposed to drink a glass of water after my run, but there's the Dunkin' Donuts. Right on the way home.
America runs on Dunkin' Coffee.
Hey, what are you drinking?
I'm drinking Dunkin'. When you get that first cup of coffee in the morning, it starts your day off right. You know, pre-coffee, you should keep your distance. Once I have my Dunkin', I'm all good.
America runs on Dunkin' Coffee.
We are back with the Bobcats holding a 38-30 lead over Hartford, the TD Bank Sports Center. Bob Mortally, along with Bob Tipson. And as before the break, Bob was mentioning about what Trish Fabry's probably thinking in terms of, yes, you got some great effort, you got some execution, and has an 8-point lead in the locker room, but the lapses. It's not a full 20-minute solid effort. It's, okay, they did a great for several minutes, then he lost it a bit, and they got it back a little bit, and he lost it again. I knowing the coaching staff as well as I have when I travel with them, I know they want the 20-minute effort every half.
Yeah, I think, though, when you're playing the goal rush or subbing as much as, you know, Trish is subbing in this game particularly, I think it's hard to get 20 solid minutes in terms of the flow. Because you've got people coming in and out of games, out of the game. You know, they're not getting that second wind or the looseness that you get when you play a few more minutes. So I think it's a little bit harder to get that feeling like you're going to get 20 solid minutes out of a team in a half when you're subbing so much. I just think it's difficult. Not that it can't be done, but I think it. Really is a case where you just got to get in the flow, and every time you think you're getting in the flow, you're getting pulled out of the game.
The turnovers, we've been harping on it already, but 17 turnovers in the first half for Hartford. Quinnipiac with 10 steals, reminiscent of the Felicia Barron days, but the defense really got them to that 14-point lead, and they made Hartford look very bad at times.
Yeah, the ball's flying all over the place when you turn it over 17 times, and, you know, we scored 15 points out of the 17 turnovers, so that's a pretty good ratio. I think the funny part is we're getting out rebounded 20 to 15, but we've got 8 offensive rebounds to their 5. So, you know, we're doing a pretty good job there. They actually outscored us in the paint, which I'm a little bit surprised with. 10-6. You know, Brittany McClain only has 5 points and she's only taken 3 shots. She's not forcing anything. But again, I think a lot of that has to do with she's in the game for 3-4 minutes. Now she's on the bench. Then she gets back in the game for 3-4 minutes and she gets back on the bench. The pace of this game really dictates almost guard play. We can get the ball up court. We can get it off to the wing. Dribble penetration kicks. And we're getting open shots. Some of them just don't go in. And we've mentioned a couple times, you know, people are doing the right thing. They're getting in the paint. They're driving. They're pump faking, doing whatever they want. And then, you know, they're coming short on the shot from 3 feet away. So, I think that they're probably talking about that. Let's make sure we go up there and finish.
And a real stunner in terms of free throw shooting. Bobcats are 13 of 14 from the line in the first half. Now, last year, Bobcat women shot about 63% for the season. That was kind of in the lower 20% of the country. And yet, during one of the preseason practices I attended, I heard Trish say, we need to make that a 10% improvement into the new conference. And to 13 out of 14, that just lights up any coach's eyes.
Yeah, and if you remember, we talked about it before the game started. Up there at Hartford, they shot 14 or 15, 16 times, and we only shot six.
We got four out of six.
You know, now it's reversed. You know, we got 14 free throws, and they're two for two, but that's pretty good. You know, I don't think they ever really got into the one-on-one situation where we were going to get hurt.
No, 17 fouls for the Bobcats, a dozen for Hartford. So a lot of good out of the Quinnipiac women in this first half. Again, after the disappointing loss to St. Joe's on Sunday, which that kind of loss could be a very demoralizing loss because they had a double-digit lead and saw it disappear. Sometimes it would take a little time to recover off that kind of a loss, but a nice effort so far against an admittedly younger, less experienced, less battle-tested squad.
Yeah, and I think the other thing, too, is that, you know, Hartford's really making it an ugly game, for the lack of a better word. You know, they're coming down and turning the ball over a lot. They're throwing up shots. You know, that one possession where that we blocked three or four shots in a row. They're making it a really ugly game in terms of the flow, and I think that's affected us a little bit. Now we're coming down and, you know, we're trying to force some shots up because, you know, we know that they're not going to score at the other end. So I think Trish is probably talking about, let's settle down, let's stay with our game plan, let's make sure we get good spacing, good shot opportunities. Let's make sure we go inside because we haven't gotten much inside in terms of our bigs. Let's get it inside and let them get a chance to either make some shots or kick it out where we can still get a three-point shot or some shots uncontested.
Yeah, you mentioned ugly basketball, and you can't get any uglier than those back-to-back sequences when the shot clock ran out. And the second time, they needed no clue, and the girl just gave up, said, here, take it.
Yeah. That's ugly.
With a capital.
I don't have anything else to say. That's ugly.
Capital U. I'll tell you what, though, with the works of the Bobcats advantage, and the Bobcats have the lead at 38-30. We have Paul Pacelli in the studio tonight once again. All the sports news, the scores, the highlights coming up just your way next on the Bobcats Radio Network.
Live from the TD Bank Sports Center in Hamden.
Step inside the most unique arena in all of college sports for Quinnipiac Bobcats basketball. Take your seat, then leap out of your seat and cheer on the men's and women's teams as they drive to the big dance. It's Major Division I MAC Conference basketball, and you're sitting so close you can see your reflection in the gleaming hardwood. Get your tickets at QuinnipiacBobcats.com. Quinnipiac basketball, the only thing as exciting as the home team is the home court.
This is George Hindinger from Hindinger Farm on Dunbar Hill Road in Hamden. The holidays are upon us, and everyone is busy shopping and planning for the perfect holiday season. That's why weekly visits to Hindinger Farm are so important. Harvest season is winding down, which makes this a great time to stock up on produce and other items for the winter. Jams, jellies, salsas, and pickle products are all 20% off from now until our closing date of Tuesday, December 17th. We still have a wide variety of apples and other produce to make your holiday table decorative and delicious. And don't forget the eggnog, which will be the best nog you've ever tasted. Stop in and look at our gift section, or look at what a great job Liz is doing with handmade swags, wreaths, and roping that are sure to make your house look festive. Again, don't forget our closing date of Tuesday, December 17th. Store hours are Tuesday through Saturday, 9 to 5, Sunday, 9 to 4, and we are closed every Monday. So come on up to the High Hill, enjoy the rural atmosphere, and we'll see you soon.
Hi, this is Mark Candido, president of Quinnipiac Bank and Trust Company, asking for your help in this year's Hamden Senior Holiday Gift Run. Look for drop-off locations throughout the Hamden area. You will find drop-off boxes at our bank's headquarters at 2704 Dixwell Avenue in Hamden. Contributions will also go to the Elderly Services Programs and the Hamden Food Bank. With your donation, together we all can make a difference.
Through December 16th, contributions can also be made at Whitney Manor, 2798 Whitney Avenue, Hamden.
And we are back here on the Bobcats Radio Network. Paul Pacelli with your halftime scoreboard update.
starting five will open up the second half for the Bobcats. They go from left to right. Inbounds pass by Guastella to Abshire. We're underway. Boo dribbles at the logo, switches hands. She's guarded by Alyssa Englert. Abshire moves to her left around the three-point arc. Now finds Martin, left corner, tied up momentarily. Back out for Abshire. She directs traffic with the left hand, dribbles with the right. At the wing, moves to her right, gets a pick from Guastella. Faces the basket. Left side, Guastella to McQueen, left of the lane with 10 on the shot clock. She turns to her right, has it knocked away. It's loose on the floor, controlled by Taylor Clark. Hartford ball. Outlet for Englert. Alyssa Englert to the forecourt, guarded by Martin. Pass to the right for Boltran. Three-pointer in the air. That's no good off the rim. Rebound. A scramble for it as Brittany McQueen is shoved off the end line, but they say Brittany touched it last. It's going to be a Hartford ball.
Well, at the other end, when Brittany caught the ball, she did a nice job. She spun and turned to the basket, but then she put the ball down below her waist.
Hartford balls, they inbound. It's Taylor Clark. Inside feed for Alyssa Reese. On the drive, left-handed layup attempt is no good off the rim. Rebounded by McQueen. She gives to Abshire. Boo to the forecourt. Pass the logo. Left corner, Martin. Drives baseline. Looks at the basket. Up off the glass. No good. In and out. Taken off by Boltran.
That's one you got to make. There was nobody around her. I don't know how she missed that.
Englert with the right-hand dribble. Stops. Looks to the far sideline. It's Taylor Clark against Guastella. She puts it on the floor, drives to the right baseline, kicks it back out for Englert. Left wing, into the lane, kicks it back to the right side. It's Lum for three. It's off the back iron, no good. Rebound tipped on the floor, loose. It's controlled by Hartford. Englert fakes the shot, throws it back on top for Boltran. To the left corner, it's Lum on the move to the foul line. The feed inside for Reese, off the glass and good.
Again, a lot of players standing around that time by Quinnipiac, just kind of standing there hoping somebody else would stop the ball.
Bobcats lead 38-32. Guastella from straight away in the forecourt, left side from Martin. Three-pointer from there is around the rim, no good. Rebound, one-handed rebound by Taylor Clark. She boxed off Guastella, and Hartford controls with the second wave about to come in for the Bobcats across the way. In the forecourt for the Hawks, Englert working on Abshire. Stops top of the arc. Right side pass for Boltran. Inside. Feed for Reese, bumps with McQueen inside, double team shot deflected. Guastella might get a piece of it, and Guastella controls the loose ball. Now outlet for Abshire, who to the forecourt. Top of the three-point arc, she moves to the right wing, gets it back to Guastella. Three-pointer in the air, front rim no good. Rebound Martin, on the drive, splits two defenders, layup is good.
Well, great job that time by Martin, as she just didn't give up on the shot. She really got the rebound and put it right back into the basket.
She banked it in off the glass, 40-32 on the other end. A whistle and a traveling violation called on Hartford. So the second five in for Quinnipiac, Warner, Martucci, Earl, Ostergaard, and Napolitano. Deanna Mays is back in for Hartford along with Latrice Hall. So 7 out of 10 subs on his first substitution with 17:43 to go in the second half. Bobcats lead 40-32. Ostergaard will throw in at the sideline just to our left. Gets it out to Warner, who gives to Earl. Earl calls gold as they start the play at the logo to the forecourt, guarded by Englert. That left side pass for Warner on the wing, facing the basket. She'll try a three-pointer. That's too short off the front rim. Rebound by Napolitano. Finds Earl. Shayna, top of the arc. She'll back it up a couple of steps and then kicks it off the leg of Englert, who punted one about 10 yards into the backcourt. So
pretty,
a kick
pretty good kick, almost a field goal.
Or it could have been a soccer shot into the net.
That's true.
Ostergaard throws in to our right on the near sideline for Warner. Goes back to Ostergaard, right wing, dribbles to her left with the left hand. Continues to move in front of the Bobcat bench. Now she switches hands as she works on Hall. Dribbles into the lane. The feed from Martucci on the right wing. Bounce pass to nobody. She's waiting for Warner to cut toward the basket. Cammy didn't move, and it's out of bounds. It'll be Hartford ball.
Well, we got to pick the intensity up here. Let's get a good defensive stop on this possession. You know, put pressure on the ball and deny some wing passes.
Nearly 3 minutes have gone by here in the second half. Hartford and Quinnipiac. Bobcats lead 40-32. In the forecourt, Engler bouncing one to the left for Boltran. Just to our left, guarded by Napolitano. Pass out to the logo for Hall. They work around the far sideline from Mazer. Mazer gets around Warner at the right wing. The feed to Clark. Overthrowing inside as Hall looked to get a little bit of alley-oop pass, but too much juice in the pass, it goes out of bounds.
Yeah, actually, it was a pretty good drive. She just threw it over her head. Otherwise, she caught it. She probably was going to make a layup because there was no defensive player in front of her.
And we've seen a couple of instances of players being a little too unselfish. Instead of, hey, we got this, you got a layup, try for it. No, I have to see an open player 20 feet away. One extra pass too many in many occasions. Earl with the ball in the forecourt for the Bobcats. Bounces one for Martucci at the foul line, goes down the lane, throws up a little floater and hits.
Yeah, great job that time again by Martucci. You know, gut balanced, nice jump shot, didn't try to force it in all the way.
42-32, Bobcats by 10 in the forecourt. Mays on the left wing. Dribbles back toward the logo. Earl all over her. Now left-handed dribble by Mesa. Weaves her way down the lane. Lost control of the ball. Tied up momentarily. Throws a desperation pass to her right. It's intercepted by Ostergaard. It's 4-on-2. Ostergaard to the forecourt. Left of the foul line. Stops in the low post. That's a poked away from behind. Taken off by the Hawks. Engler controls for Hartford. Pass to logo. Top of the three-point arc. Moves to the foul line. To Mesa. Left corner jumper for three is good.
Well, they're living on the three right now and doing a pretty good job of hitting the open person. Standing there with nobody on her.
42-35, second three from Mesa. She has 8 points in this game. A starting five at the bench for the Bobcats. Earl at the left wing to Martucci. Right in front of the foul line, 17-footer. Off the rim, no good. No second chance. Bolton with the rebound for Hartford. Quickly finds Englert. Engler in the forecourt to the right wing. Stops the foul line, kicks it back for Boltron. Three-pointer, back iron, no good. Rebound, taken off by Ostergaard. One dribbles and he gives to Earl. Back we go the other way. Shayna passed the logo with 15-18 to go. Second half to Ostergaard. Three-pointer, left wing. Air ball, missed the rim altogether. Ball loose, tapped around, and it was a last touch by the Hartford Hawks. So it'll be Hartford Hawks ball after the timeout with 15 minutes and 10 seconds to go in the second half. It's Quinnipiac leading Hartford 42-35. We'll be right back.
I wonder how much money he makes.
Your attention to center court for a brief presentation. The Quinnipiac Department of Athletics and Recreation would like to take a minute to recognize the most recent accomplishment of the Quinnipiac Women's Ice Hockey Program. Last weekend, the Bobcats claimed the 2013 Nutmeg Classic title for the fourth time in the last 5 years. The Bobcats defeated RIT 8-0 in their first game and then overcame a two-goal deficit to defeat Yale 3-2 in the championship game. Kelly Babstock finished with 7 points at the strength of 1 goal and 6 assists and was named the tournament's most valuable player. Congratulations, Quinnipiac Women's Ice Hockey. Quinnipiac substitution number 33, Boo Abshire. Number 31, Samantha Guastella. Number 20, Brittany McQuain. Number 22, Ellen Cannon. And number 24, Jasmine Martin. Into the game for Hartford, number 14, Morgan Lum. Number 11, Caitlin Skinner. Number 24, Alyssa Reeves, number 25, Amber Bepko, and number 31, Sherelle Moore.
Attempt hits the bottom of the backboard. Ballislu gets it back. Martin forces it up against a taller player, and she draws contact, and a foul's called on Hartford.
Yeah, she just basically missed the shot and then took the ball right away from a Hartford player who rebounded the ball, then turns around and gets it back up on the rim and gets fouled.
Amber Bepko with the foul, her first, and the first on the team. Actually, Bepko's second personal foul as Jasmine Martin makes the first free throw. Jazz at 15 against Hartford last December up in West Hartford. Second free throw around the rim, no good, and it's rebounded by Sherelle Moore of Hartford. Outlets for Morgan Lum. Lum to the forecourt. Left corner for Bepko on the drive. Throws the back out ball loose. A scramble at the logo, and they're going to call a backcourt violation as Lum tried to dive to save it.
Again, that's that like we were talking, the passes are not crisp. The people are getting the hands on the ball. It's being... It's just not nearly as smooth as either team would like.
43-35, Bobcats by 8. Cannon, left wing, bounces one inside from McQuain. She faces the basket, left of the lane, goes inside. Now back out Abshire to the foul line. Left wing for Cannon once again. Shot clock at 13, back on top for Boo. Abshire brings Lum out with her with 10 seconds to go on the shot clock. to the left corner. Martin fakes a three-pointer, draws the defender, now pulls the trigger and buries it.
Ah, great patience that time. You know, she's ready to shoot the three, see somebody coming by her, fakes, get her to go by you, and then resets and makes that three.
That head fake was priceless. It's 46-35, Bobcats by 11. In the forecourt, Hartford ball, Moore, right wings, puts two defenders to the foul line. Short jumper is good. Jarrell Moore, second bucket, makes it 46-37. Inside of 14 minutes to go, second half. Abshire for Wastella, straight away beyond the arc. Pass to the left, it's deflected out of bounds. Intended for Martin. Betco got a hand on it and knocked it over to scorer's table.
Again, we still haven't seen, you know, McQueen really get the ball in the post area. It's all been perimeter play.
Abshire, between the circles, gets a pick from McQueen, now moves to her left. 15 on the shot clock, 13:45 in the second half. Dribbles to the right side, out of the right corner for Cannon. Stops, bounce pass inside, double teamed as McQueen feeds on the cut to Guastella, who drives, can't hit the layup off the back iron. It's rebounded by Reeves.
That was a great play that time. Again, didn't finish, just what Trish said at halftime.
Lum to the foul line, goes back out for Caitlin Skinner on the left wing. Pass on top of Baltrin, right side for Moore. Watch by Guastella on top, Lum. Lum spinning at the foul line against Abshire, force up a two-handed jumper, but it's no good, and it's rebounded by Abshire. Abshire for the Guastella, outlet for Abshire. Boo, left wing, back for Sam. Facing the basket with five subs, waiting at the scorer's table. Inside, McQueen, turnaround shot is good from 6 feet out.
Yeah, that's the first shot I think she's taken in the second half, and it's only her fourth shot of the game.
48-37, Bobcats by 11 with 12:55 to go, second half, and a whistle. And seven subs come back into the game, five for Quinnipiac, two for Hartford. Martucci, Napolitano, Earl, Ostergaard, and Warner for the Bobcats. And we'll set the Hartford lineup as we go. Boltron is still in the game, and she inbounds to Alyssa Englert. Englert's watched by Martucci in the backcourt. She dribbles to the foul line. A little bit of a bump there. Martucci kind of winked one eye and said, I don't believe you made that call.
Well, I think what happens is you get a tendency like you want to try to steal. Instead of moving your feet, you're trying to move your hands in there, and then you get out of balance, and she winds up getting a foul.
Martucci second, team's first. Not very many fouls here on either team in the second half, just one each. Hartford with the inbounds pass. It's Lum. Now to the left side for Baltrin. On the drive, goes on two defenders, forced up the shot. She goes down, but a foul against the Bobcats. Ostergaard second. And a second on the team here in the second half.
Pretty good move that time as she took the ball down with her left hand and then literally split two Quinnipiac defenders in the air to get that shot off.
Boltrin, just one of two from the line this season, had 6 points in a recent outing against Missouri at the Miami Thanksgiving tournament, and she makes the first. That's 7 points for Boltrin this evening. Junior from Watertown, Mass., and it's a 10-point game once again at 48-38. Takes her time, nice and quiet in that sea of seats across the way to the left, but the second free throw is no good, and it's rebounded by the Bobcats. Earl brings it across the logo to the forecourt, 12:36 to go, second half. Stops a dribble, bounces one to the right for Warner, pass for Napolitano, juggles it momentarily, then controls near sideline. Back to the low post for Warner, face of the basket, kicks it back out for Martucci, left wing, brings it out to the left corner. Now drives to the left baseline, goes underneath the basket, but I believe she got her foot on the end line.
No, she got fouled.
Okay. Here's the indication.
Defensive player for Hartford kind of stuck her knee out there and kind of hit her, knocked her out of bounds.
Sherelle Moore picks up her second. Second team foul on the Hawks with 12:19 to go in the second half. Napolitano will throw in. End line to our right. Gets it into Warner, left corner. 16-footer from there is an air ball. Napolitano inside with a rebound. The putback is good.
Great pass that time.
Should we credit her with an assist on that?
Yeah, I think you should.
50-38, Bobcats by a dozen. On the other end, offensive foul is going to be called as Englert plowed into her defender as she was getting a pass off to an open teammate in the left corner. And Earl, a little slow in getting up, but she's biting her lower lip and will play through it.
Yeah, she got plowed into, no question about that.
Englert second personal and the third team foul on Hartford. Quinnipiac ball, Ostergaard across the logo to the forecourt inside of 12 minutes to go, second half. Left wing, now to the left corner for Martucci. Back for Ostergaard on top, inside Warner, low post, spins to her right, run-hander off the rim, rolls in.
That's a great job. When she really gets somebody on her back, she kind of like straightens out, gets them back off a little bit and then takes that spinning layup.
14-point lead matches the biggest of the night for the Bobcats with 11:37 to go in the second half. Clark out on top for Meza. They work it to the near sideline for Engler. Engler penetrates at the low post on the left side. Spins, pass deflected by Martucci. She's able to recover on the end line and gets the ball off to Earl. Long downcourt pass, though, is intercepted. Intended for Napolitano. Picked off by Boltrin. Right side pass for Meza. Into the forecourt on the wing. Gets around Martucci. On the drive, the flip to Moore. Shot is blocked out of bounds as Warner got a hand out of it. And also the torque there knocked Moore to the floor. So it'll be Hartford ball after the timeout with 11:14 to go in the second half. Quinnipiac with a 14-point lead, 52-38 on the Bobcats Radio Network.
Live from the TD Bank Sports Center in Hamden.
Step inside the most unique arena in all of college sports for Quinnipiac Bobcats basketball. Take your seat, then leap out of your seat and cheer on the men's and women's teams as they drive to the big dance. It's Major Division I MAC Conference basketball, and you're sitting so close you can see your reflection in the gleaming hardwood. Get your tickets at QuinnipiacBobcats.com. Quinnipiac basketball, the only thing as exciting as the home team is the home court.
Has life passed you by? With work, home, bills, responsibilities, how about a break for you? This is Dan Darling. I want you to be inspired today through CoffeeBreakForTheSoul.com. You can read a text, watch a video, even journal your own thoughts or share a thought. So come and be inspired today through CoffeeBreakForTheSoul.com. Subscribe today.
Well, both teams have picked up the pace just a little bit after the first media timeout. It's now a 14-point lead for the Bobcats once again, and the turnovers now 23 for the Hawks and growing by the minute.
Well, and, you know, and 10 for Quinnipiac, and I'm sure Trish isn't real happy with that either because they've thrown the ball around a little bit, just made some bad decisions. But, again, I think when you look at what's happening out here, you're looking at, you know, three-point field goal percentage in the second half. 1 for 5 for Quinnipiac, and Hartford's 1 for 4. So neither team is really shooting the ball well from the outside. And again, we've got 22 points off turnovers, and 14 and 12 in the paint versus Hartford. So I think we really need to settle down a little bit, get some spacing. Let's see an offense that's run where maybe 2 or 3 passes. Get the ball inside to Brittany, or whoever's, in this case it's Cameron because she's in the game, but let them make some decisions in terms of either they're going to go to the basket or skip it out to the opposite wing for a shot.
Angler to throw in for Hartford in line to our left. Needs some help, waiting for cutters. Nobody's open just yet. Now she finds Meza, has to leap to grab it outside the arc. Right wing down the lane. Layup attempt against Ostergaard is good, and a foul is going to be called as well. Ostergaard's third personal. And the third on the team, so an opportunity for a three-point play for Deanna Meza.
See, I think what happened there is she's driving to the basket. Rather than stepping right in front of her, she kind of went to the side of her, and that created the foul, versus if she would have stepped a little bit further over, I think she'd have plowed right into her.
Meza makes the three-point play. She had 20 points against Loyola in the lone Hartford victory this year, and of that 20, she was 10 of 11 from the foul line. Now a partial substitution. We all five in? Yeah, all five starters are back in. Cannon,
yep.
Martin, Abshire, McQueen, and Guastella. So it's Abshire facing double-team pressure in the backcourt. Pass to Guastella across the way. So take her time getting it across into the forecourt against Latrice Hall. Now to McQueen, just outside the foul line. Back for Abshire, right wing. 10:55 to go, second half. Abshire, top of the three-point arc. Bounces one to the left for Cannon. Shot clock at 10 to Martin, left corner. Doesn't dribble right away. Looking for help. Puts it on the floor once. Shot clock at 5. The boot to McQueen. To Abshire, right corner. For downtown, shot off the rim. No good. Martin on the end line. Tried to tiptoe it, but couldn't. And it's going to be Hartford ball.
But you know what? It was a good play. They got the ball to the wing. They threw it back into the post area. She got played. She kicked it out to the opposite side. It was an open shot. There was nobody on her. She just missed it.
Bobcat still with the lead, 52-41, 10:30 to go, second half. Hartford with the basketball in the forecourt. Taylor Clark in front of the Hawks bench. Out on top for Engler. Left side pass, Meza takes Cannon with her. Doesn't dribble right away. Two-handed pass for Boltrin. In front of the Hawks bench. Pass down low, intercepted by McQueen. And she gets it out to Abshire. Another turnover for the Hawks. Bobcat ball. Abshire for Cannon. Near sideline. Goes into the low post. Guastella turnaround one hander, no good off the rim. Rebound taken out by Englert, and she's pushed from behind and a foul against the Bobcats.
No, I don't think it was a foul. I think she just, Brittany McQueen just went down in there and tipped the ball out of
all
bounds.
Right. Did see contact, but they're going to call it out of bounds, so it's Hartford ball with 10 minutes to go exactly in the second half. Bobcats with an 11-point lead, 52-41. Englert waves her teammates around, gets a movement, pass inside, knocked away by McQueen to the half-court line, recovered in the backcourt by Meza. Meza brings it across. Left side pass for Englert, moves against Martin, lost control of it, ball's loose, and knocked away into the hands of McQueen. Finds Abshire, boo-boo the forecourt. Back for Brittany, straight away, left side Cannon on the wing. 9.5 to go, second half. Cross-court feed from Martin on the right wing. Moves to the foul line. Passes to Abshire. Now to McQueen. Turnaround shot from the lane is short off the front rim. Rebounded to Boltron. Boltron bounces one. Pass is stolen in the backcourt by Abshire. 1-on-2. Boo splits two defenders. Takes the extra step, and she's called for traveling.
She got the NBA step. I don't know why they call that.
Because we ain't the NBA. So a couple of subs now for Hartford. Sherelle Moore returns along with Morgan Lum and Alyssa Reeves. So Hartford subbing not quite as liberally as Quinnipiac, but getting multiple substitutions in as well with 9:19 to go in the second half. 52-41, Bobcats by 11. Hartford ball in the backcourt. It's Lum with the right-hand dribble on Martin. Pass to the right for Meza. Meza one dribbles at the logo, stops, needs help. Pass to the near sideline for Boltron. Out on top for Moore. Moore against Guastella. Flips it over to Lum to the foul line. Kicks it to the left corner. It's Meza for three. No good. Air ball. Rebounded by McQueen, who's hitting the head, but no foul called. And it gets the pass off to Abshire. Now to the left corner for Martin. Splits two defenders. Pull up jumper from 12 off the rim. No good. Meza with the rebound. All of 5'7". She gets the rebound. Quickly brings it up court. Top of the arc. Pass deflected by Cannon into the hands of McQueen. It's Quinnipiac ball. They give to Abshire with 8:37 to go in the second half. Abshire slows the tempo down just a little bit. Watched by Lum, bounces one to the right for McQueen. On the wing, out on top for Martin. Five subs on the scores table for the Bobcats at the next opportunity. Bloop inside for McQueen, left side of the lane, back for Martin. Right corner, three-point attempt is short. Rebound, McQueen at the low post, fresh shot clock for the Bobcats, gets to Cannon. Cannon thought about a three-pointer from straightaway. Inside finds Guastella. Right corner jumper. No good off the rim. Rebound Moore. And it's Hartford ball. Outlet for Meza. She's on the run. Does not have numbers. Meza to the foul line. Goes up against Cannon. Forced the shot way off the mark, though. Rebounded by Reeves. Finds Boltron. Three-pointer. Left wing is good.
Well, again, you know, Hartford's made it ugly. They just they really have got us playing that kind of style of basketball.
Boltron with three threes in the game, and it's 52-44. Bobcats by eight, 7:43 left. Second half, Abshire bounces one of McQueen at the foul line. Turns against Reeves. Double team momentarily. Now dribbles a couple of times. Jump pass for Martin, has to save it. With 10 on the shot clock. Left wing moves to her right. Gets a pick from McQueen at the foul line. Five on the shot clock to Cannon. Splits the defenders down the lane. Scoop layup attempt too hard. No good. Rebound taken off by Hartford. It's Boltron in the forecourt against Martin. Now Boltron wide open for a three-pointer from the right side. No good. Rebound, though, taken off by Morgan Lum. Able to get it away from Martin. Lum dribbling top of the three-point arc against Martin. Stops her dribble. Needs some help. Finds a teammate. It's Moore in the left corner. Now out on top for Meza. Guarded by Cannon, approaching the 7-minute mark of the second half. Meza on Cannon, moving to the right, gets a pick, works around Guastella to the right wing. The feed inside, intercepted by Abshire. 1-on-2. Abshire racing down the right side of the lane. Her layup is no good off the rim. Rebound batted around, controlled by the Hawks. It's Lum, who falls down in the backcourt. A foul's going to be called, and Abshire kind of slaps the basketball in disgust as Quinnipiac picks up the foul in the backcourt. They're going to call a foul on Martin, her second personal. Team's fourth and a timeout on the floor. 6:47 remaining in the second half. Quinnipiac still with the lead at 52-44. We'll be right back.
Get your coffee from the folks that know coffee inside and out. For over 60 years, we've kept America running with our dedication to serving the freshest cup of coffee. Dunkin' Donuts. America runs on Dunkin'.
You neglected to mention the sleeper sofa. I forgot all about the air hockey table. Reluctantly helping my friend move.
Get going with
the one and only taste of a Dunkin' iced coffee, and reluctantly help your friend move. America runs on Dunkin'. You want your coffee quick, freshly brewed, and ground from only the finest beans. Make the most of your day with the fresh ground taste of America's favorite cup of joe. At Dunkin' Donuts, you can do it. Dunkin' Donuts coffee, America runs on Dunkin'.
Bob Mortali and Bob Tipson at the TD Bank Sports Center. We were talking during the timeout about how rough things are getting here for both teams. Nobody's going to get any style points on this one when this is over because they're getting awful rough out there.
Yeah, I mean, it's, again, it's a game that we're playing exactly the way Hartford wants us to play. Just rushing up the floor, taking quick shots. You know, when we don't have a three-on-two break, we're making them turn the ball over. I mean, there's 40 turnovers in this game, 28 by them and 12 by us. That's not too many by us, but, you know, we should, if we're turning the ball over, they're turning the ball over 28 times, we should be winning this game by quite a few points at this point.
The second five is in for Quinnipiac. Brittany McQueen was on the floor during the timeout, getting a little bit of treatment from trainer Becky Mella, and Brittany with some water on the bench. It's Hartford ball. Englert finds Meza. Now they move to the right side. A fast inside on the cut to Morgan Lund. The layup attempt rims the basket. No good. And a whistle on the rebound. A foul's going to be called inside, I believe, against Warner. That'll be her first.
Yeah.
And five team fouls now at Quinnipiac.
She got her, she was going in, she bumped her on the layup, which made her miss it, but.
Morgan Lum at the line for the Hartford Hawks. Last game, career high 16 against St. Francis of Brooklyn. That was a consolation game of the Miami Thanksgiving tournament. The free throw rims the basket, no good.
You know, she's a 71% free throw shooter, so.
Scored 11 against Providence. That was her collegiate debut, did not play in the first two games for the Hawks early part of this season. Second free throw, basket to our left is good. So one out of two for Lum, cuts the margin to 52-45, a 7-point Bobcat lead as Earl works in the forecourt on Englert. Right-hand dribble at the right wing. Stops, left side for Ostergaard, goes right back to Earl, she moves around to the left wing. Dribbling outside the three-point arc, not a Martucci, left baseline jumper, too much juice, air ball. Rebound, Ostergaard trying to control on the end line, they said last touch from behind off the hand of Meza.
Again, open, wide open shot. We're not even hitting the rim.
Too much juice on those shots.
And it's a good shot. She's got to shoot that.
Or maybe take that half a second to size it up like we saw in the men's game the other night at the end by DJ Irving.
But again, she's a good shooter, and it just looks like she's getting a little bit too anxious to shoot it. When she's so wide open, she probably is.
Earl inbounds to Warner, right of the lane, goes on the floor, double team goes back to Earl, right corner. Immediately back to Warner, turns to her left, hook shot off the back iron, no good. Rebound off the floor, taken off by Morgan Lum. She races against four white-shirted defenders. She'll pull it back out. Now to the left side for Englert. Pass to the defender, the bounce pass inside for Rees, tied up, and a foul's going to be called against the Bobcats. Napolitano second. And team's sixth foul here in the second half. Three team foul for the Hawks. Alyssa Rees had 11 points against Central Connecticut just prior to the Thanksgiving tournament. Also 12 rebounds against Loyola, misses the first free throw. Just 3 of 12 from the line this season. 52-45, inside of 6 minutes to go here in the second half. Second free throw is good. Getting a little dicey for the Bobcats now, lead down to six. With 5:55 to go, second half. Earl walks it across the midcourt line, met by Englert, moves to her left across the three-point arc. Closely guarded by Englert, stops the dribble on top of Martucci. Right side of the foul line, falls down, but she may have been pushed, and a whistle for a foul against Latrice Hall.
Well, I think what happened was they kind of knocked knees there. She gets the foul, and unfortunately, she didn't get a shot off. Maybe she could have got a, you know, go to the foul line.
They actually called it on Morgan Lum, her third. And the team's fourth, and the horn goes off after the pass is thrown in. The officials say play on, and Earl will do that as she dribbles at the top of the three-point arc. Right side pass, Martucci, down low feed for Warner, right baseline. She's double-teamed, inside off the hands of Napolitano, recovered by Ostergaard. Left low post, forces the pass to Martucci. Three-pointer from the right wing is no good. Off the front iron, and a whistle away from the play as Ostergaard got tangled up a bit with Englert and a foul call. That's Ostergaard's fourth. And 17 fouls now on the Bobcats. with two subs for Hartford about to come in. Taylor Clark returns. Same for Shanice Boltron. So with 5:24 to go in the second half, again, a little bit of a lull for the Bobcat offense. What happened, a 14-point lead is now down to 6 with foul shots coming for the Hawks. It'll be Englert as two of the officials. Now all three of the officials converse at the foul line to our left. Could there be a question as to who should be the shooter here?
Yes, I think that's exactly what it was.
So we will have video replay as to the officials across the way to look at the TV screen to get a better glimpse as to the last play. And I'll do my best to kind of lean over your shoulder here as we can watch the TV replay again, trying to figure out who actually was fouled and who should be at the foul line with 5:24 to go in the second half. The Bobcats with the lead at 52-46. Quinnipiac has led by as many as 14 points on a couple of occasions. There have been some mini runs by the Hawks both in the first half and here in the second half. Now on the rebound, rebound was clearly captured by Mesa, but I see Ostergaard. I can't make out the number of the player in the red shirt. It looks to be 23 from my angle. Sorry about the cord. And it probably will be Englert taking the free throws once this is all said and done. In any event, it's a 1-1.
Which is the one that was on the foul line when this whole thing started. So she knew she was going to the line.
They got the call right, which is why replay was instituted in the first place. So it'll be Englert at the free throw line to our left. Hasn't scored yet tonight and still hasn't scored. She missed the free throw, rebounded by Warner. Needs some help, gives it to Earl with 5:20 to go in the second half. Earl works in the forecourt, past the logo, guarded by Englert. Top of the three-point arc, bounces one to Warner, left of the foul line. Feed inside on the cut for Napolitano. Tried to go back door, but she couldn't control the pass. Out of bounds, Hartford ball.
Well, nice idea, but you got to catch that ball. I think she was trying to shoot it before she actually caught it.
There is a sequence to this, and she had it backwards. As we approach the five-minute mark of the second half, Mesa, guarded by Earl, throws it in the forecourt for Englert. Now to the far side for Taylor Clark. Brings Warner out with her, out on top for Hall. Bounce pass to the left for Englert. Guarded by Martucci, back for Boltron. Right wing, the bounce inside intended for Latrice Hall. A foul inside, that might be Nikki's foul. That's five. Let's wait
and
see.
That's it. That's the one.
So Nikki fouls out with just 1 point on the night.
1 point, one rebound.
And 0 for 3 from the field, 0 for 2 from downtown.
Scored her 1 point on the old foul line. Which is, I guess, the only way you can get 1 point.
In this sport, yes. You can't score 1 point in Canadian football. The league, we don't have the time to explain that. So we got five starters back in for Quinnipiac. Cannon, Martin, McQuain, Guastella, and Abshire. At the line is Latrice Hall. 6 points, six boards against Loyola of Maryland in the most productive game of her season. The free throw is good.
Well, this is the group now that you've got in the ball game. You know, with 4:48 left in the game, I think you're probably going to just go with this group unless somebody gets hurt. But, you know, I think you stay with this group now right through the end of the ball game.
Deep breath on the second free throw by Hall. Too hard off the back iron. She does have 7 points, but the rebound taken up by Guastella. Outlets for Abshire. Dribbles across the far sideline with 4:40 to go in the second half. Pass to the left corner from Martin. The boop inside for McQuain, back to Abshire. Three-pointer from the left wing is good.
Nice inside out that time again. And, you know, Brittany didn't force anything. She knew somebody had to be open because the double team came.
55-47. The lead is back to 8 for Quinnipiac. In the forecourt, Mesa works on Cannon. She'll back it out to the logo. Directs traffic with the left hand. Pass to the left for Englert. Guarded by Martin. Near sideline for Clark. Clark doesn't dribble. Sets it up on top for Hall. 4:12 to go second half. Left side pass for Boltron. Guarded by Abshire on the wing. Out on top for Hall. Drives to the foul line. Pulls up 16-footer. Grazes the front rim. Rebounded by Guastella. Looks for Abshire. Boo with the right-handed dribble in the forecourt inside of 4 minutes to go. To Guastella. Top of the three-point arc. Left side from Martin. Martin takes her time. Now Boo throwing to Guastella. Left of the lane. Faces the basket. Out to Cannon. Right side. Pulls the trigger. 4-3. No good off the rim. Rebound goes into the hands of Boltron. And she takes it away from Guastella. And controls for Hartford. Now out to Hall. Ball to the forecourt, dribbles to the left wing, past the foul line, lost control of it, out of bounds, poked from behind at the end by Cannon, so it'll be Hartford ball with a substitution. Jerome Moore will come back in, and a timeout on the floor. 3:37 left, second half, Bobcats in front, 55-47 on the Bobcats Radio Network.
Live from the TD Bank Sports Center in Hamden.
Step inside the most unique arena in all of college sports for Quinnipiac Bobcats basketball. Take your seat, then leap out of your seat and cheer on the men's and women's teams as they drive to the big dance. It's Major Division I MAC Conference basketball, and you're sitting so close you can see your reflection in the gleaming hardwood. Get your tickets at QuinnipiacBobcats.com. Quinnipiac basketball. The only thing as exciting as the home team is the home court.
Christmas is a time of favorite customs and traditions, and among them should be a visit to the Knights of Columbus Museum. Enjoy the museum's annual creche exhibition, Ordinary Materials, Extraordinary Message, a collection of Christmas nativities in paper from throughout Europe and the United States. The Knights of Columbus Museum is open daily from 10 to 5 at 1 State Street in New Haven. Bring your friends and holiday visitors. Admission and parking are free. Visit kfcmuseum.org to learn more.
Bob Mortali and Bob Tipson at the TD Bank Sports Center. We talked about some of the growing pains on this young Hartford squad. They're also in the midst of a long stretch of games away from home. Their last home game was against Central Connecticut November 26th. They have one home game between November 26th and January 4th, and that's a home game against Vanderbilt on the 15th. After here, they play at Boston College, at Maine, at Sacred Heart, and a trip to Penn State late in December before returning home on January 4th against Dartmouth. So not only are they having growing pains on the court, they're getting used to playing away from home very often.
Well, you know, and we see two players over there, you know, in braces. So, you know, maybe those players are players that they were expecting to, you know, really help them through the year. And, you know, I don't know if when they're getting them back. Those braces that they've got on are kind of big.
Well, I know one of their players, Mallory Shakora, has been banged up. We saw her last year in West Hartford. Shakora is a sophomore from Little Falls, New Jersey, but saw minutes against the Bobcats in last year's meeting up at the Chase Family Arena. Hartford inbound with 3:37 to go in the second half. Quickly fit pass inside is intercepted by Jasmine Martin. She gives to Abshire. Bobcats with an 8-point lead, 55-47. Abshire to the right wing, goes inside to McQueen. Double team as she faces the basket, kicks it back for Cannon. Takes her time. 3-pointer in the air, no good from the right wing. Abshire, though, with a rebound, and she dribbles right of the lane. Cross-court feed for Guastella. Pump fakes, not a Martin. Left corner jumper is off the rim, no good. Rebound fought for, taken off by Meza. Hawks on the move. Meza to the forecourt. Left side pass for Engler. Thought about a three-pointer, gets it back out to Meza instead. Pass the foul line, down the lane, layup, no good, and she's fouled. She'll go to the free throw line.
Well, we're doing a pretty good job at least making them pass the ball around, but then we're turning around and fouling every time down the floor, which means the clock stops as they go to the line. You know, scoring points with the clock not running. I think everybody would just like to get this one over for Quinnipiac. Get it, you know, get that win and get in the locker room.
McQueen's third personal foul, 9 on the team. It's Meza with the free throw. It's good, and she's miss automatic for the Hartford squad, among the leading free throw shooters on the team, and has hit all 4 attempts tonight. Jarrell Moore goes to the bench for Hartford. Latrice Hall returns. 3:01 to go, second half. 55-48 with a free throw to come for Deanna Meza. Second one is good.
She might be in the nation. She might be one or two in the nation because she's up in the high 90s right now.
I would imagine so. 55-49, 6-point lead. Pressure in the backcourt. McQueen, though, is open. Gets to Martin at the midcourt line. She brings it across. Far sideline now. Taking her time, dribbling at the left wing. Out on top for Abshire. 2:47 to go, second half. Bobcats lead by 6. To Cannon, left wing, forecourt. Low post for McQueen. Turns to her right. Pump fakes. And she's hit on the shot. She scores. She's fouled.
That was a tough shot she made. She got banged on the elbow and still made that shot. Great job that time by Brittany.
She almost welcomed the contact and still controlled the shot nice enough to shed just enough momentum off the backboard to score it.
And she kind of pumped her fist like it's about time that one went in.
So Cameron Warner comes back in for Samantha Guastella. And for Hartford, it'll be Alyssa Reeves. And she'll take out, I believe that's Taylor Clark. So McQueen attempting the three-point play. She converts, and she's in double figures with 10 points. Makes it 58-49. The lead is 9 with 2:39 to go in the second half. Englert in the forecourt for Hall. Hall working on McQueen, on Warner, and she gives to Meza on the curl. Dribbles top of the three-point arc. Left side pass. Almost knocked away. Hall able to control it at the near sideline. Drives to the lane. Bumps up McQueen. The layup attempt no good, though. And Brittany takes the rebound down. Outlets for Abshire.
Strong rebound, too. She pulled that one with two hands.
She may be getting a little testy with all the physical play inside. Maybe getting a little frustrated, but she got that three-point play a minute ago. It's Warner near sideline, 2:10 to go, second half. On top for Martin, left side Abshire. Facing the basket, shot clock at 12. On top for Cannon. Right side, Martin. Goes to the right low post. Double team. Pull-up jumper is off the rim. No good. Rebounded by the Hawks as Hall controls. Under 2 minutes to go. Second half. Mesa in the forecourt. At the foul line. Stops. Triple team. Pass knocked away. Recovered by Warner. I'll look for Abshire, who's out of the field. Goes down the lane. Lamp attempt is knocked away from behind, but a reach and foul is going to be called as Mesa poked it away but drew contact there.
Yeah, I think that was a pretty good play, to be very honest with you. We would have gotten the ball back, but I'm not so sure she didn't get anything but the ball on that little slap down.
So good credit, Mesa credit for hustling and making Abshire work from a foul line for these points here. Mesa second personal, just 16 fouls for Hartford. Abshire's first free throw is good. She's hit all five tonight. Now Morgan Lum returns to the Hartford lineup, replacing Englert with 1:45 to go and a 10-point lead for Quinnipiac, 59-49. Abshire, second free throw, rainbow shot, it goes in. 13 points for Boo. And it's 60-49 with 1:40 to go, second half. Mesa in the forecourt working on Martin, gets a pick. Now works on McQueen, right side of the lane, out on top for Hall, left side. It's Lum for three, no good air ball, rebounded by Martin. She gets it out to Abshire with 1:28 to go, second half. Abshire taking her time, approaching the midcourt line. There's a bump at the logo, but Abshire controls. She moves it across. Another bump, no foul call as she and Mesa kind of bump with each other. And Abshire now eats up some clock here. 14 on the shot clock, 1:14 of the game clock. Abshire still dribbling far sideline. 8 seconds on the shot clock. Now stops, bounces one to the foul line from Martin. Right at the foul line, goes down the lane. She's tied up and lost control of the ball. Taken off by Hartford with 1 minute to go in the second half. Lost control in the backcourt, but it gets the pass eventually over to Blum. Now to the left side for Boltran for a three-pointer. That's off the rim and over the backboard, out of bounds. Now timeout called across the way. 51 seconds to go in the second half. Coach Jen Rosati calls the timeout for Hartford. Bobcats with an 11-point lead and possession. Not a lot Coach Rosati can do here, I don't think. I
mean, it's no, you're not going to win the ball game. But what you may want to do is you want to, you know, want to set your press up just to see that these kids understand what they're supposed to do in the pressing situation. But there's no question, you're not winning this ball game. It's just you know, with 51 seconds, you know, you're down 11. Not much he's going to say over there. I know she just made a substitution, but I think you really want to just set your press up, see what it looks like. So you can examine it on film.
Boo Abshire, the leading scorer so far. 12 points for Boo tonight, including all six of her free throws. And 10 points for Brittany McQueen, 7 boards. Brittany still with an opportunity by maybe late February of joining the 1,000-point, 1,000-rebound club. She came into this game well over 1,000. She had that milestone before the trip to Missouri. And as far as rebounds are concerned, well, she had 851 coming in. So she's approaching 860. Only three other Quinnipiac women are in the 1,000-1,000 club, and only one of those, Ashley Kelly, did it in the Division I era.
Diamond, Ashley was a pretty good player.
Diamond Doe in for the first time for Hartford, a senior from Lynn, Massachusetts. Warned to throw in Abshire. Double teamed immediately in front of the Hartford bench. Still needs some help. Falls down, able to get the ball to Warner, who dribbles along the end line and a whistle. And a timeout call, I believe, by Quinnipiac.
Yep. And again, I think that's all Rosati was trying to do is to really say to her team, okay, let's work on the press right now. Forget what the score is, but let's try to really trap hard, see if we can get a steal. And if they throw the ball out, get it out, let's make sure we get down in transition defense. So good teaching moment, and I think a good job by them because they really did had a nice trap over there in the right corner.
60-49, Bobcats by 11. And if they keep Hartford scoreless once again down the last 46 seconds ago, that'll be three straight games Hartford's failed to break 50. So some pressure still in the backcourt as Warner will throw in. Looking for movement, looking for a cutter. Gets it in the corner for Abshire. Double team once again, try to split it. She's fouled immediately.
But again, I think Hartford, they wanted her to go to the corner where they could trap her. They tried to trap, and Boo is smart enough to split the trap and get fouled as she comes out on the dribble.
Again, some substitutions for the Hawks. Boltron and Lum return. Going out is Doe and Clark. 44 seconds to go, so they didn't eat up a lot of time there. 2 seconds off the clock, and Abshire with the free throw. It's around the rim and gets a friendly. No, it didn't go in. It bounced four times on the rim, but it's controlled by McQueen on the rebound. Gives it back to Abshire. Boole on the left wing, guarded by Lum. 38 seconds to go. Again, Boole will take her time. About a 13-second difference with the shot clock. Now she finally made her move. Blocking foul is called on Lum as she fell when Abshire started to make the move to her right.
No, and Boo does a nice job because she knows that as long as she's got the ball in her hand and dribbling, they're not going to turn the ball over. She's a good foul shooter.
First attempt is good. The foul is on Morgan Lum, her fourth, team's eighth.
So you really want the ball in her hands at the end of the game, just because I think she makes pretty good decisions.
It's the ball from the official with 31.5 to go. 13 points on the night for Boo. Make it 14. 62-49, 30 seconds to go. Englert on the forecourt against a double team. Gives it out to Lum. Lum drives right of the foul line to the right corner for Taylor Clark. On the drive shot, blocked from behind out of bounds. Lee McQueen got a hand on it. And it'll be Hartford ball with Shayna Earle returning to the Quinnipiac lineup. Abshire was headed to the bench and did a U-turn. Cameron Warner's going out.
Yeah, you want your ball handlers in there right now.
Boltron throws it on the end line. Finds Lum, three-pointer, left side air ball. Rebound off the floor, controlled by McQueen. Looks for help, finds Abshire across the way. 14 seconds to go. Abshire into the forecourt, splits two defenders. Bounces to Martin with 9 seconds to go. Still spinning. Hartford players just playing close. And then a reach-in foul at the end with 4.7 to go as Lum got a little over-exuberant. She just fouled out.
Yeah, usually in that situation, everybody just backs away. You don't know why she was out there trying to steal the ball.
And she's replaced by Milana Gilbert. 62-49, it's in Jasmine Martin to the foul line, who's one of two from the line tonight. Only 6 points, a struggle from the outside, just 2 of 14. Free throw in the air, back iron no good. Rebound controlled by Boltron. She sends it up court to the half court line for Englert. Pulls up, shot blocked at the end by McQueen, and that's it. So the Bobcats led throughout much of this game and come away with their fourth victory of the season. The final, Quinnipiac 62 and Hartford 49. Stay tuned for the postgame show. We'll be right back.
Here's to Guastella. Now to Lee back along the right sideline. Dribbles into the lane and out to Guastella. Top of the key for three. Good.
Quinnipiac Bobcats basketball brought to you by TD Bank, America's most convenient bank. By Pepsi, the choice of a new generation. By Dunkin' Donuts, America runs on Dunkin'. By Moro Motors, Mercedes-Benz and BMW of North Haven. By Mass Mutual, they like to help you make good financial decisions to protect the people who matter most to you. And by the Beach House Restaurant in Milford. What's not to like? Great food, great staff, super music.
Every season starts with a